from behind. Riders are getting away, as we just see here, pushed off Scotty Lechuga from America, but I don't think they're going anywhere because they're too far behind.
And we haven't seen any movement from Roxanne Kneteman, one of the famous names of Dutch cycling film.
Very much indeed. Jerry, was it her father?
Her father, yeah.
Yeah, he was the world champion back in 1978. He was a great friend too, Lady Kneteman. Yeah. He had some bad crashes too in his career. Once saved his own life. He hit a car and he had to stop. He broke an artery, and the only reason he lived before the ambulance got there, he tied up his whole arm with his hand and held it dead tight, and he came back to be world champion.
Now, Kate, the tempo in the peloton has really calmed down.
Well, I think the riders are very nervous. Falls, they reverberate through the peloton in a wave of nervousness, but nobody is going to push the pace while the riders are rejoining unless it's a crucial time in the race. It's not. The riders are just rolling along. Whether the riders can rejoin or not, that's another thing. But the peloton are certainly not in a hurry to go anywhere. I think the only thing we'll see is some of the riders wanting to get to the front and stay out of trouble. A lot of those crashes happen with a touch of wheels as they try, a little bit in desperation, to come up the side when they see an opportunity for acceleration. The first thing on the map, Phil, is the intermediate sprint.
Yeah.
They're not quite there yet. I think we'll see the pace increase significantly heading into that.
Yeah, 47 kilometres into the day of the 113 is the first sprint in Torquay. Famous for its surf, and on this occasion, famous for the Deakin University Elite Women's Road Race. I think here now they've kind of relaxed now there's been that crash, and they've turned off what was becoming quite a dangerous cavalry charge. Nobody behind. The women are riding back there, but I can't see them rejoining the group. They lost too much time.
Well, even if they do rejoin the group, what's the damage that's been done?
Yes.
The confidence has been knocked around, the physical damage as well, the energy spent trying to rejoin the race. This is the Specialized Women's Racing Team at the front. That's Ella Bloor that you can see at the head of the peloton, number 112. The Kiwis, the New Zealand national team, they're all young riders. They're all under 23 years of age, the New Zealanders. And in particular at the recent Santos Tour Down Under, Grace Anderson looked very good.
Grace Anderson was tremendous. She took out the young riders competition, and she's very young and very humble. And I think she was, to start with, just very honoured to be part of the race. That's Scotty Lechuga.
Yeah, she looks as though she's going pretty well. Now, this technically is a 100% illegal, riding behind a team car. There's only one penalty, disqualification.
I'm shaking my head a bit. It's almost the unwritten rule that after a crash, the cars will help you back through the convoy. It's not clear from that shot whether the car is, in fact, at the back of the convoy, but
based on the aerial
technically
shot,
technically that's not really good form. But in saying that, Matt, I don't think the other riders would have a massive problem with doing that. They don't see it as cheating, in fact. So I'm going to call it a grey area, that rule. On paper it might look very firm, but actually adherence to it, yeah, it tends to be a bit more grey.
That aerial shot and a chance to take a look at the convoy. It's not a particularly long convoy in this race, and I'm certain with how long that she was on the side of the road that that car was not at the tail end of the convoy, and there was a big gap between that car and the chase for Lechuga.
I was giving the benefit of the doubt there.
Well,
once you hit the back of the convoy, you're safe again, you know, even if you take your time to jump one car
there's
at
the evidence.
A time. Oh, that's, yeah. We'll see what the commissaires say about that.
Heading now down towards Barwon Heads, the home of Cadel Evans, when he's in Australia at least.
That's also true, but Cadell's right here in Geelong at the moment. He saw the start of this race. He'll be very much in evidence for the men's race on Sunday as well. They've got their tempo going again. At this sort of tempo, no one can get off the front of this bunch. So the wind is being very kind to them. It will pick up, I'm convinced, on the borders of the ocean as we swing away into Barwon Heads and down the 13th mile.
Well, we can see it's very open, so when there are crosswinds, it absolutely rips the field apart. The weather has been very kind to the athletes today. I think there'll be
a few
of them.
We don't want it to be kind,
relaxing.
Really, do
we? Well, we don't. We love to see the action, but I know some of the teams For every kilometre, that is a little bit calmer. They take a deep breath and get a bit more confidence heading into the second part of the race.
Just watching Eri Yonamin from the Wiggle High Five squad. She's the champion of Japan. There's how we bring you the pictures off to the right from our helicopter. Rides off clear of the race, of course. He doesn't want the downdraft of the rotors to make a problem for the race.
We can see from the pictures, Phil, that there aren't actual gutters on the edge of the road. So sometimes when the field is spread out the entire width of the road, you do have some problems with falls, because if you get a little bit too close, there's almost no safety net. If you flick off into the sand or the grass, you can be quite reactionary in how you handle your bike to get back in. The athletes need to take care with that. Often when they're fatigued, they're the little mistakes that can cost a rider, a group of riders, the race, essentially.
Number 31 sitting towards the back of the peloton, that's Chloe Hosking. It was her teammate, Roxanne Kenaderman, who was one of the riders who crashed. And we haven't seen any signs of Roxanne Kenaderman returning to the race. We'll bring you any updates that we are able to get from out on the road. Also on that team, Mayuka Hagiwara, the former Japanese national champion. She's also a contender today. She's finished on the podium in this race in the past, and she'll be one of the dark horses with the LA Cipollini team, if that's possible when you're wearing such bright colours. Drop to the Deakin University Kill 11's Great Ocean Road Race, the fourth edition of this event. And today, Geelong is showing off. The weather conditions are ideal. Temperatures rising towards 30 degrees and barely a breath of wind. All the yachts, they're docked in Corio Bay. Let's now take a look at the course. It's 113 kilometres. They start neutral in Geelong through the Botanic Gardens, head down towards Barwon Heads. Then along 13th Beach, where the wind could be a factor, into Torquay for the first of the Mapai Intermediate Sprints. On to Bells Beach for the first of the Subaru Queen of the Mountains points. Along Forest Road and through to Ceres for the next of the sprints in the race for the Mapai Sprint Queen jersey. On to Chilamba Crescent, the most critical point of this race, and also an opportunity to pick up points in the race for the Queen of the Mountains prize. And then the finish line in the heart of Geelong, right on Corio Bay in front of Steam Packet Gardens. Phil Liggett is with me. I'm Matthew Keenan. And Phil, today the weather conditions are perfect. We have a brilliant international field headed up by the Mitchelton Scott team.
We have 15 top women's teams here in the world. We've got the world number one here, of course, Van Vleuten, and a great field. We're opening up the season here in Victoria, and after this they'll be heading across through Asia and Europe. And it's a beautiful day, as you say, Matt. Not enough wind for my liking. It might increase once we're out onto the 13. The race is underway, so let's have a look at the story so far.
Scott Sullen, the race director, bringing the flag in. The first rider to attack was Barbara Gurici from the Virtue Cycling team. She was the initial aggressor, and then once she was brought back, it was Lisa Monzetti from the B Pink squad who went off the front. We then saw a nasty fall. The biggest victim of that we've noted so far is Roxanne Kenaderman. The New Zealand national champion, Georgia Williams, was also caught up in that crash. And so too from the 2020 squad, Luguchi, who's trying to make her way back to the peloton. The peloton is all still together. The weather, though, they'll be pleased with it. Those that participated in the Swiss People's Ride this morning, the weather was a lot cooler then. But we're heading towards a top of 30 degrees today. But Phil, as you alluded to a moment ago, the wind traditionally in this race has been a major factor. Today it's only 9 kilometres per hour, and it's just been swirling around, no real clear direction.
No direction at all, and it's a breeze at the moment, nine kilometres an hour. It's just over 5 miles an hour. As we're looking now at another little move going off the front, this is Abby Snedden, the Australian on Sydney Uni stage. That crash we saw came 10 kilometres into the race. It's 113 kilometres, about 70 miles in total.
And once again, it's the B Pink team trying to get into the breakaway. Velasecchi, another one of the Italian riders from the race, is trying to go into that break. Also responding, this is Anna Trevisi. So the Italians so far have been the aggressive. All the three major attacks have been led by Italian riders.
might tell us something. There's an awful lot of Australian riders who would like to win this race, of course. Two Australians and a Dutch woman in the history of this race have been the winners. Last year's winner was Amanda Spratt, Van Vleuten and Rachel Nayland back in 2015, all in the race today. Well, that has really stretched this field out because we've been doing what I call tempo riding at round about 43, 45 kilometres an hour. But now, as we're closing in on Torquay, first sprint point, one woman trying to get clear of the field here is Abby Snedden.
And really good to see the Sydney University Staminade women's cycling team really showing plenty of aggression in this race.
It's great to see the domestically based team, Sydney Uni Staminade, are doing a great job. We've seen the pink at the front of the bunch quite a lot today. We can tell that they're quite set on making their mark on the race. As you look through their start list, there's not one rider in particular who we would say is necessarily the big threat from them, but they're certainly taking the bull by the horns, so to speak, and making and animating this race. A lot of the way that you win bike races, Matt, is just through aggression tactics and animating it. It's almost you got to be in it to win it. And if they are riding along all day at snail's pace, that's not going to happen. They have had a fast tempo today so far that no breakaways have been allowed to succeed. She's opening a good gap, but Phil, gee, you don't really want to go alone, do you? It's a big ask with a lot of kilometres left to race.
And that is the only reason the peloton has not reacted here. One woman is not going to make it home on this course, and they know it. So they'll leave her out there as a carrot, see if it attracts someone else to try and get up to her. But with the climb at the end of Shalamra Crescent, this high speed will cause the race to break up on that climb.
Oh, when you attack like that, you have these moments where you turn around and there's nobody with you and you kind of think, oh, no. Gee, I wish I had a mate out here to keep me company and roll some turns. But she's certainly going for it, rider number 125, Georgia Whitehouse from the Staminade Sydney Uni team. I think she figures she's out there, she may as well give it a good crack. She's made the effort so far, and she's riding with a steady pace, steady tempo.
And she's now coming into Barwon Heads as we'll head out onto the road as well, as we're joined by the three-time green jersey winner from the Tour de France, Robbie McEwen. He can't help himself. He's still in the race, but he's out there on a motorbike. Robbie, what have you made of the first 20 kilometres or so?
Well, Matt, as you said, I'm in the race, but my only way of keeping up with these elite women is on the back of the motorbike, so I'm happy to be here. Beautiful day, and as you've alluded to, very little to no wind. So it's been limited to sort of minor skirmishes, just individual attacks going up the road. And then we saw, of course, that nasty crash where Roxanne Kniedemann, we stopped very briefly, and it seems she had a lot of discomfort on the left side of her ribcage. That's what she seemed to be complaining about, telling the medics, and they were actually just about to put her into the back of an ambulance and take her off to hospital for scans. But she was conscious, she was talking, she was moving her arms and legs, but she was in quite a bit of pain. So it's a real blow for Roxy Kniedemann to be out of the race with a crash, and also so soon after just 10 kilometres. And I think the team will also really miss her presence, very experienced.
And such an innocent victim. She was taken out from behind. But what I do like, Robbie, is that you're using your motorbike pilot, Fletcher's back, as your clipboard.
Yeah, you can see that. So I've just actually pilfered some tape off the back of his motorbike, torn it into little pieces. So I've got all the information I need in front of me with the whole start list. But interesting, though, I'm seeing from the back of the peloton at the moment, a lot of our pre-race favourites are happy at the moment to just hang down the back and take a back seat. I can see Annemiek van Vleuten from here. I can see Amanda Spratt, just two riders across from her. I've seen Chloe Hosking hanging around the back. So that wind is really not a concern, and they're just happy to let their teammates do any necessary work to hold the field together, and they'll make their attack when they want to later. But because there's no wind, it's really quite a relaxed atmosphere in the bunch, and they're just cruising along and enjoying the sights as they come into Barwon Heads now.
Thanks, Robbie. We'll get down to Robbie regularly throughout the race. As we go back to the head of the race, this is Georgie Whitehouse from the Sydney University Staminade women's team. She's making the right-hand turn. If she had have kept going straight, it would have been over the famous bridge of Barwon Heads and towards Ocean Grove. This is Hitchcock Avenue that they're heading down now. And his Providor is down to the left-hand side, which is the favourite cafe of Cadel Evans.
Yeah, there's one, two very nice cafes down there, some good pie shops as well, as we're now making our exit from Barwon Heads. It's a very, very nice area to live. Blue waters off the shoulders of the riders. Heading out now to Torquay. We're approaching the sprint in the old days of this race, over the last 3 years. We've moved the sprint point down to Torquay, 47 kilometres into the 113. Everybody staying together. As Robin McEwen said, there's no wind factor is actually causing no opportunity on this course at the moment to attack.
That can change. It's difficult from the television to see the impact that the wind does have, but the way we can see it is through the tactics and the way that they're riding. When there's strong crosswinds, we often see them break up into echelons, into straight line, where some riders can gain some advantage over others. The no wind factor is really playing into the hands of Georgia Whitehouse. The field, they're not chasing at all. Georgia is probably pretty happy to be in a breakaway, but probably wanting a little bit of company, a bit lonely out there.
Well, the point that she's on now, this is along 13th Beach, and this is a stretch of road that has been used in the past for the Jayco Herald Sun Tour. And in 2009, they had a stage finish right here next to where the golf course is. And it was so windy on that occasion, with Chris Sutton winning the stage ahead of his teammate, Bradley Wiggins, that when the stage presentation was done, we were standing underneath a almost 5 metre awning, hard up against the back of the stage presentation area. The wind was coming down sideways and was still getting wet from around about the waist down. It was blowing a fierce gale. Today, it couldn't be better. And some of the most stunning coastline in the country. In fact, some of the most stunning coastline in the world.
Well, let's hope it's the calm days are aiding the endangered hooded plover, which lives on the beaches here. And there's a huge problem because people's dogs tend to crush the eggs. But it's a very, very rare plover now. Also home of the orange-breasted parrot. In case you don't know, which migrates far away from Tasmania occasionally.
Oh, some facts there I didn't go. Know there, Phil.
They're your indigenous birds, not mine.
Well, we sit here and look at these beautiful pictures coming through of this gorgeous coastline. The riders don't have much of a chance to take that in. Georgia Whitehouse, she's got an almost 30-second lead now. Until it goes out to over a minute, she has no support from a team car, so should any misadventure happen, she will be swallowed up by the peloton waiting for any service. We wish no misadventure on her, though, of course. I'm not sure it will get out to a minute. It has been hovering around the 25 to 30 second mark for a while. They're almost playing a game with her.
And she's playing it with the peloton. She's just hovering out the front as much as they're just allowing her to be there. She's not going full gas at this point. She's desperate. She's gone fishing. She's got the hook out there with a little bit of bait trying to draw somebody out of the peloton and into the breakaway boat with her.
Well, they say out of sight, out of mind, but the peloton can still see her up ahead, save for a few little twists and turns. So long as you can see them just up there, it's just a dangling carrot for them. She really isn't riding too hard. She's riding consistently and solidly, but, you know, she's sitting up. She looks pretty relaxed.
You could see how easy she was taking it. She was sitting on the tops of the handlebars as opposed to the brake levers or into the drops. She did ride the Tour Down Under just recently, finishing in 68th position. She was consistently just in the middle of the field. But that will have given her some confidence that she can ride in an international race. And good to see her getting off the front.
You've always got to admire an attacking cyclist, and you don't build your reputation by staying anonymous all day long in the peloton. So you almost always must take your hat off to an attacker. So good luck to Georgia Whitehouse, even if it probably won't get into the finishing line in first place. But once we get over the other side of Torquay, the undulations increase. There's some rough hills waiting for these riders, which we don't talk about as King of the Mountains, or in this case, Queen of the Mountains climbs.
Well, we don't expect this breakaway to stay away for the entire day, but what it does, Phil, is take the pressure off her teammates. They're sitting back in the peloton. They know they don't need to do a thing. They don't need to sit near the front. They don't need to pay as much attention as the other teams to that time gap. It's sliding out a little bit more toward the 40-second mark as we see some beautiful aerial shots. Really is paradise down there on the Great Ocean Road.
No, it's a lovely, lovely scene. I've never seen it look so calm. Normally they're dodging the sandstorms that blow off their heads here. But everybody is watching the race go by, and the women are watching progress here of Georgia Whitehouse. Not one of the big names yet in the world of Australian cycling, but she might be one day. She's edged out to 36 seconds, 86 kilometres, just under 54 miles for all our international viewers.
It's a benefit the Australian riders have at these races, the domestic teams, three of which are out there, Sydney Uni Staminade, Holden Gusto, and of course Specialised Women's Racing, that the international riders may not know their names, and that relative anonymity can help them in breakaways like this. It can really play into the hands of the Australian teams. Phil, it's such a good opportunity for the domestic riders to be represented. We've had two Australian winners in the past three editions, Rachel Nail and, of course, Amanda Spratt. Last year, Annemiek van Vleuten, she spent the whole summer surfing and cuddling the wildlife. We could almost adopt her as an Aussie.
You could, but that put her off to the best season she's ever had. Remember, she is the woman in Rio who crashed and looked as though she died on the spot in the Rio Olympic road race. It was a horrible, horrible crash. She tweeted less than 24 hours later she was fine. She didn't look fine on the tweet because she was in hospital, but she came back this last year and had a finer season. It was a fairy tale comeback, and we've already heard her say her close relationship with her mum. Well, you can only imagine what her mum thought when she saw that crash on worldwide television in Rio de Janeiro. She's back now as the world number one, less than 12 months later. 38 seconds is the gap. She's pushing it out as best she can. It might make a minute. They're not chasing her. They're just holding her tempo speed at the moment. Watch out for the great white sharks. That's all I can say. Do they have great white sharks here?
Oh, of course they do.
Just checking.
Are you planning to head out for a surf later?
No. I never will go in the ocean. That's the domain of others.
When the tide is out like this, it's perfect for beach cricket.
Beach cricket?
Beach cricket.
Well, perhaps the Brits will beat you. The English. We play beach cricket.
How you bring families together is cricket on the beach in summertime, particularly down this region.
The way this peloton is riding, they're just waiting for an opportunity and just keeping the tempo.
Rider number 15 there, Rotem Gavinovich. She's from Israel. We talked to her in Adelaide about what an honour it was for her to represent her country. There's not a lot of Israeli representatives in the international cycling field. It's great to see the diversity of nations. One of the team 20.
Well, this is the girl
riders
who fell. This is Scotty Lechuga, who clearly has come back to the field courtesy of a car. And she looks as though she now has a problem she wants to sort out.
When we see them reach down to their jersey like that, they do have race radio. So when she picks her jersey up, she's talking to her director in the team car. What then happens is the commissaire will wave them up, and in this case, she's actually dropping back, but if she sat at the back of the peloton, the commissaire would wave their team car up. Perhaps a bit of inexperience in dropping back, but there's a number of her teammates doing so. I'd suggest a bike change.
Yes, I think so.
And they're waiting for her to pace her back onto the field. She's done a lot of chasing today. That will definitely pay later on in the race.
That was damaged in the fall quite clearly, but no time to change. Or maybe it's back to her. It is. It's back to her own bike. She took a spare bike to get back to the race. Now she's got her own bike back.
Because this bike has got the race number on it, whereas the bike that she stepped off did not have the race number on it. So they've fixed up the damage that was done to that bike throughout the crash. But as you mentioned, Kate, a small sign of inexperience by going back to the team car as opposed to staying at the rear of the peloton and waiting for the car to come to her.
That's a long way back too.
There's a lot of little nuances in road cycling that can really help and play into the hands of the more experienced riders. Riders like Amanda Spratt riding for Mitchelton Scott, that's the kind of knowledge she imparts on the younger, newer riders to the peloton. She tells them these little tips and tricks, and of course their team directors do as well. But she's got two teammates there that will help her pace back on, Erica Clevenger and Danielle Morshed. Three is better than one, Phil. They'll allow her a little bit of recovery. She's done a lot of chasing after that crash already. Make their way through the convoy. The smart way to do this is to take a little bit of rest behind each car and break the effort up. They are doing that. You can see them weaving in and out. It takes a lot of experience by the convoy drivers as well to know that the athletes are in the mix and not cause any accidents.
Well, there's the three names for you. This team is managed by Mari Holden, who herself was an Olympic silver medalist a few years ago, and Mari has brought them over. And she clearly tells them how to ride a bike race. Only one Cuban on what is basically an all-American team.
What does that tell you, though, about Lechuga's protected position within that team? The rider that crashed, she's one of the older riders in the team, one of the older riders in the race at 35 years of age. She's had some success. She's won a couple of stages in a few smaller races. But she comes here after finishing in 33rd position at the Santos Tour Down Under. Yet that team doesn't have a clear standout leader. Perhaps she's the one that they think can perform well on this course.
I'd also say safety in numbers. For Scotty to continue to contribute to the team effort, a little bit of assistance will only put a bit of fatigue in three riders' legs rather than essentially taking Lechuga out of the race after too many solo sustained efforts. So it's very savvy riding by the 2020 team as a whole. They've got Nicola Cranmer sitting back in the car. Actually, I'll tell you what, I'd love to see a bit of a race amongst the incredible Director Sportives back in the car. We've got some incredible CVs amongst them. It's wonderful to see them impart their knowledge, their strategy, their experience in the sport to the new generation. Team 2020, it was built 8 years ago. It was Team 2012 at the time to develop the younger athletes for the Olympics and to go on to professional teams. They've had some great success with some athletes doing that and also supporting some athletes from the track. Georgia Whitehouse from Sydney Uni Staminade. She's been out the front for a while. She's hit that magic minute mark. We didn't know if she'd get there, but that shows her motivation and also the peloton's motivation in not being too tenacious to chase her down.
So for her now, she knows that nobody at this point is going to come across and quickly bridge that gap solo, as might have been the case when she was hovering at the 20-second advantage. So we're heading towards Torquay, which is the first point in the race for the MAPI sprint classification. And then it's on to series for the second of those destinations. She might start to daydream about an opportunity to get up onto the podium as the winner of the sprint prize.
Well, that's a good thought. Well, she's taken 10 kilometres to gain 1 minute.
As they turn right, if they had gone straight, they're onto a wonderful bike path that takes them a shortcut across towards Torquay. And the facilities in this area are getting better and better for cycling. I wonder how much just the presence of Cadel Evans has influenced the local councils and shires in the creation of more support for cyclists, particularly recreational cyclists.
Yeah, I would agree. He's certainly put the area on the map because he lives here. It doesn't originate from here. It's Northern Territories person, actually, before he came south. We've only ever seen him as a Victorian, though.
Everybody around the country wants to claim him.
Yeah.
He was born in Katherine in the Northern Territory, spent some time in Armidale, New South Wales, and most of his teenage years were in Arthur's Creek in the outskirts of Melbourne in Victoria. Now, well, although he's predominantly based in Europe, in Switzerland, he does have a home here in Bowen Heads.
So the commissaire has just rolled up next to Georgia. What I presume the message being told is that the gap is now 1 minute, which usually means that the commissaire will okay their team vehicle to drop in behind her and give her support. If not, they'll certainly send the neutral car out there. If you look,
There's a crash in the peloton, I'm hearing. There's a Trek rider down, and we'll see if we can get pictures of that for you. The peloton have livened themselves up here, and there it is.
And it's a lot of riders involved. A number of the riders from the Virtue cycling team. A former Polish national champion has been caught up in it, number 83, Wilowska.
Yeah, and Abby Snedden is down there near his camera. She was in the attacking moves a little bit earlier on. Jean Courtevoir, the Dutch girl, in the light green colours there.
Molly Weaver is also there from the Trek Drops team. Two riders from that squad.
Well, they look as though they're all getting slowly away from the scene, which is a good sign. But again, another disruption on the straight road when the field appeared to be reacting with high speed.
And the response now coming from the peloton, that adds tension to the race. The advantage for our sole leader, Whitehouse, is now plummeted down towards the 45-second mark. This is Snedden trying to get herself going once again. Wasn't that long ago that we saw her attempting to force the breakaway.
Yep.
And the convoy of cars for them to try and leapfrog their way back to the peloton in is spread out a long way in front of them. This is one of the riders from the B Pink team who's trying to go away once again. And I wouldn't be surprised if this is Lisa Monzetti.
80 kilometres out from the finish. This is a tricky little road, this one, now, for a while.
There's nowhere to hide. Long, straight stretch of road, this, so you can be within sight even if you've got more than a one-minute advantage. So it makes it very difficult for the breakaway. Peloton, though, Cape, they've really slowed down.
They have. The breakaway will certainly be strengthened. If we get two out in front, it's certainly a much stronger proposition for survival with two riders than one. We can see Whitehouse looking over her shoulder as she rounds the corner, likely a little bit buoyed by seeing somebody come across and help her with the efforts. Phil, look, take a look at her top tube there. You can see two cubes. You know what they are? They're actually gels. They're part of her race nutrition sitting right there on the top tube. And maybe it's so that she doesn't forget to eat, but certainly easy access there. We can just see the jelly globs. I think that's probably the technical term, jelly glob.
I used to love those, Matt, but you can't eat them and commentate. It's a shame. She's about 13 kilometres from the sprint point. That's a long way to stay in front. She's 63 seconds ahead now. This is Lisa Marzenti, who was out originally on the early move, 10 kilometres into the race start itself. Now she's at it again.
She was aggressive on Thursday, and there's no change on Saturday. At the front of the peloton, we can see riders in those bright colours of L.A. Cipollini. That's Swinkles, number 36, riding towards the front. Number three for the Mitchelton-Scott team, that's the youngest rider on that team, Janelle Crooks. No pressure on Janelle Crooks today to perform for herself. Her responsibility is to look after Annemiek van Vleuten and Amanda Spratt.
And sitting on the front of the field, as she has been fairly consistently throughout the race, she's a bit of a lieutenant for today. Likely she's been asked to just sit there and patrol and make sure nothing dangerous gets away. She's almost the first responder of the team, if you will, to give the other riders, the protected riders, Amanda Spratt and also Annemiek van Vleuten. Don't forget Gracie Elvin. We haven't seen much of her this season racing, but I know that she's certainly in a lot of form. The crash riders rejoining the back of the peloton. It just goes to show that the riders have taken the pressure off a little bit. The peloton starting to slow down. The gap to the breakaway is going out somewhat. We can see them a bit of freewheeling, Phil. They're certainly taking their time to take a deep breath, get a little bit of recovery.
All the fallers took advantage. Everyone is back from that incident we saw now.
To the gap between our sole leader, Whitehouse, to the peloton is at 111, 112 now. But Lisa Morzenti, the Italian from B Pink, she's just 20 seconds behind, or 28 seconds behind the front of the race. Kate, if you could get into the earpiece of Whitehouse, what would your advice be at this point?
It would be to ease off just 5 or 10% because help is coming. Her best chance of survival today is absolutely to join forces with another rider. It will strengthen them. So it is worth sacrificing a little bit of advantage just to get that help. But Morzenti is tiring already. We can see her cadence has dropped. Her gear has increased. That's a sign of fatigue if ever I saw one, as well as the hunched shoulders. She's looking over her shoulder too. It's a dead giveaway when they start looking behind them, because when you are on form, you don't care if they're 5 metres off your wheel. You still charge ahead. She's a bit unsure, but she's kind of stuck in no man's land. The peloton, they don't look too interested.
No, they might well open up a gap here. Look at it, 123 now to the leader over the peloton. And that is Whitehouse. She's still got 11 kilometres to stay in front to get those first sprint points.
Well, with that in mind, for the first of the intermediate sprint points in Torquay, does she wait for the Italian? Or does she try and make sure she gets the points by staying off the front on her own and then wait?
Well, then I guess that really goes to strategy for overall race. So if they're chasing a jersey, some intermediate sprint points, and that is what they're after for the day, absolutely, Georgia Whitehouse, you go, girl, because this is your opportunity to stand on that podium and get some points in the MAPEI sprint classification. She does look like she's not slowing down at all. Earlier, we did say that an indicator of how hard she was working was sitting up on the bars, but she's now out on the hoods and giving it a bit more stick, so to speak.
This is the Italian Morzenti, and you can see her body language. She can see the sole leader, Whitehouse, just around the corner with her following support car. 25 seconds, just a little kick out of that corner to get back on top of the gear and maintain the momentum.
And she's going to get across. She's going to get across because the field at the moment have decided to wait and see. and I think she'll get across in the next 3 kilometres. She's closing very quickly.
Often when the athletes are in this position where they're stuck in no man's land, you break it down and you think, 5 kilometres, I can do this for 5 kilometres. I'll just keep it steady and try and jump across. We can see she is a bit fatigued, but she'll get a lot of relief if she bridges over to White House, and then the peloton can pay a little bit more attention if they are two out up front. As we can see, they're still rolling along. They don't appear to be too interested. I'm not surprised. Two riders at this stage in the race that don't have massive CVs behind them, they're probably not a big threat, but the peloton would want to keep their eye on them.
Almost out to 2 minutes for White House out in front as they're on Blackgate Road. And this is one of those roads that it looks flat, but as you're heading towards Torquay, it's ever so slightly uphill. Only around about a 1% gradient.
A false flat.
But it's enough.
A false flat can burn the heck out of the legs, especially in this midsection of the race. And often you don't even realise the damage that's being done until you try and accelerate up a climb or through a sprint, and your legs are a little bit dead.
And there's the other end of that bike path that we alluded to earlier on. They could have taken the shortcut.
Absolutely. I'm glad we found that. There's the sweep. They've turned completely off just at this minute in time, waiting for somebody to do a counter move, because we've got 2 minutes now, which is good to see. Taking full advantage of the lull in the peloton. They're coming together, these two. Cannot be too far away. She hasn't wasted a lot of energy, this woman here, White House, pedaling low gears, sitting up nicely.
And her high cadence is an indicator of relative freshness. She takes on some water bottles from neutral support there. It's important to stay hydrated while you're out there, Phil. We've seen that she's, you know, got food on the mind on her top tube. She's now taking on hydration. All those things start to wear at the back end of the race if you don't pay attention early.
Well, Chloe Hosking, speaking before the race got underway, she said it's a race in two, this one. The opening battle in the crosswind and then trying to survive the climbs. She expected that to be the case today, even though it is almost dead still here in Geelong. It hasn't eventuated, much to everybody's surprise. As we look at the Italian Lisa Monzetti into the classic time trial position now, Kate.
She looks a bit more comfortable than she did. Her cadence has increased. She went through a tough patch a few kilometres ago. I would suggest that she can see Georgia Whitehouse in her immediate view now, and that spurred her on to just make that last-minute effort to get across.
And perhaps in her mind.
Yeah.
Georgia, I'm just here. Why won't you wait for me?
Well, we haven't seen Georgia look around for quite a number of kilometres now. She did before she turned that corner, but I think team directions were to truck on somewhat and really head into that sprint, which is at the 66-kilometre mark, so 9 kilometres away from her. But Mozenti's just behind, so it'll give them both a little bit of recovery and a little bit more chance to defend that break. It's out to a couple of minutes. The peloton don't seem too interested, but what we really want to see is these pair come together, work together, give each other a little bit of recovery. Quite different riding styles between them. Georgia Whitehouse, very high cadence, very fluid, very efficient way of riding, especially on roads like this.
Well, she's a very, very good pedaler. So much so, I begin to think her gears are stuck.
Well, she'd be a good track rider.
Yeah.
This is a
nasty little... It's a bad... Yeah.
It's an example of this road that I alluded to earlier on. It's got these nasty little drags in it. And I'm sure that you've ridden this road quite a few times, Phil.
Yeah, well, I was never at the front, so I never saw the climbs.
Very clever.
I was always at the back.
Cagey.
I could feel the pressure on my legs, though.
Well, we can see from this shot that it is slightly uphill. I'm not sure that there's a Strava climb segment going up here, but it's certainly wear on the legs. Both of the riders within striking distance there for Mozenti to get up to White House. White House isn't waiting for her, but I think she'll be happy when she gets there.
This small airfield that you can see off to the left-hand side, they do a lot of skydiving from out of there. I've had the privilege of jumping out of a perfectly good aeroplane from that airfield.
Then what did you jump out for?
Because it was my 30th birthday and my wife had updated the life insurance.
Okay. Tiger Moth World. Riders now not too far away from Torquay, about 8 kilometres.
And the director in the car for the Staminade Sydney Uni team is Joanne Hogan, and she was a very impressive cyclist herself. She retired only a season ago, and she's now imparting her knowledge on the young riders. She's pumped. She's really excited to have a young group of ladies to mentor and teach the craft to. And can I say, she's doing a pretty tremendous job. They've got some real talent in that team. And under her guidance, I think that we will see some really big gains made by some of the young riders.
What Joanne is making sure that the Sydney University Staminade team do is have an impact on the race. Joanne was a silver medalist at the Australian Championships around that torturous course at Mount Buninyong. And they're a team that don't have a big favourite to win. So they're shaping the race.
The team officials just checking in, letting her know the status of what's happening out on course. Checking in to see if she's okay. She's not hesitating. She went over and had a chat to them, but she's certainly not slowing down. The instructions certainly weren't wait. And if they were, she just flat out ignored it because she's really powering ahead. They've got 8 kilometres now to go, 7 kilometres into this first intermediate sprint. She's sucking back some big breaths there. She's working very hard.
Yeah, there's no waiting. 18 seconds is her advantage over Lisa Morzenti, the Italian who's doing the chasing. Back to the peloton. They're now at 2.5 minutes behind.
And not too motivated to go anywhere from the looks of it. Team Tibco on the front there in the blue jersey with the yellow and blue stripe. Team Virtue Racing with former world time trial champion Linda Willemsen at the front on the left there. And Ale Cipollini just patrolling. Chloe Hosking, their sprinter, the Australian.
Seeing the Tibco team at the front with the bright yellow helmets on and that stripe of blue across their chest. Seeing them on the front, how much does that tell you about the confidence that they've got in their new recruit, Shannon Molsey, the Australian champion?
Well, Shannon Molsey deserves their support, Phil.
They do. And in fact, Team Tibco have never raced in Australia before in their lives. The whole team coming here for the first time. They were down in South Australia, now they're here. And their first victory of the year was Shannon Malseed winning the national title. And for the first year, the team were coming to see her. So they've had a wonderful trip so far. And don't be surprised to see them in the action.
Well, it clearly caught them ever so slightly off guard because throughout the Tour Down Under for Shannon Malseed, she had to wear a jersey that was used as the presentation jersey when she won the Australian Championships with sticky tape over various sponsors that weren't consistent with the sponsors of her trade team, which is Tibco Silicon Valley Bank.
Well, she's very happy to be out there. Sans gaffer tape on the jersey, and the kit looks fantastic. Annemiek van Vleuten coming to the front. Another
This is the leader of a mechanical problem for Whitehouse. So Morzenti, the Italian chasing, will not only get across, but she might go out in front.
Oh, this is devastating. This is interesting. The mechanic's out of the car, but there's no wheel support.
There was no communication early in anticipating. That's a lack of experience from Whitehouse. She's had a rear wheel puncture, and clearly the team wasn't aware of what was happening.
This is a disaster. This is really a disaster for Whitehouse. She's worked so hard out on course. Both herself and the team have had, I'd like to say, a little bit of a shocker there as Morzenti has just ridden straight past her. She needs to get back on the bike.
And now she finds herself chasing.
Well, that's a real shame. But that was unfortunately a botched job. And she's now in second place.
Still polite, though. As she got pushed off by the mechanic, she still had time to say, thank you.
Oh, the last time I saw that happen was in 1978 in the Tour of Zambia, when they called the rider back because he hadn't said thank you to the mechanic.
Well, there's never an excuse for bad manners, gents.
No, especially as this is a women's race and a top-class event at that. Georgia 3 minutes is a big gap.
It is a big gap. She needs to just maintain her composure. She might have a little bit of adrenaline running through her system. She remounts the bike. A few issues with the gears there, but she's in good hands. Shimano Neutral Service is sitting right next to her if that wheel causes her any problems.
She run the risk of that little bit of panic and going too hard too soon once she gets rolling again?
Oh, naturally, especially with that rush of adrenaline. I'd love to see her in a slightly heavier gear. The higher cadence is very efficient, but I think that she's quite a strong rider to get a break out to 3 minutes. She's proved that she does have the legs on. She's in the big chain ring, and I hope that she can just compose herself, take a few deep breaths, and get back up and form a twosome. We didn't see that coming, did we? We thought that Morzenti would duck across to her and they'd form a pair that way. If Morzenti doesn't wait a bit for her here, I think that's a tactical error. Between them, they have a lot of strength. One out, not nearly as much. It'll be interesting to see how this pans out. Peloton's still not very interested.
No, I think Whitehouse will cross that gap. It's not very far in front of the to Morzenti now, so we'll see. This is the peloton still deciding what to do with the day. 71 kilometres out, still a long way, and the roads get much more difficult as well. They're gonna, but if they hit 4 minutes, they're giving themselves quite a target.
Well, leaders of the race, they're just on 4.5 kilometres away from the first of the intermediate sprints in the race for the MAPEI sprint classification. That first sprint is in Torquay. Two riders away, 2.5 minutes. That's updated. We're closer to 3.5 minutes according to our GPS tracker. The Wiggle High Five team milling towards the front.
The riders have been out on course for 45 odd kilometres, an hour, just over an hour and 10 minutes into the race. That shows us that's a pretty high average speed, 45 kilometres in an hour 10. So while the pictures make it look like the peloton are taking it pretty easy, actually they're ticking along at quite a speed. Lisa Morzenti, she's looking around, wondering what happened to Georgia Whitehouse.
She's waiting. Here she comes.
She's about to find out. She can ask her in person now.
Well, two's better than one, that's for sure. 3.5 minutes a lead as they come together. 4 kilometres out from the sprint.
Little bit of a welcome party for her there.
Yeah, all I could hear was from Whitehouse was, oh, OK.
Perhaps Morzenti was saying, you can do a turn now. Oh, okay. They need to share the workload up here. If only one of them takes responsibility for the pace, that is a recipe for disaster. I expect to see them swapping quite even turns. I hope that Whitehouse, as a slightly more inexperienced rider, doesn't take too much responsibility, but a nice little flick of the elbow there to get Morzenti to take up the speed, take up the pace.
Almost looks as if they're teammates, and they'll be riding as if they're teammates for quite a while. But the Italian at the front, she rides for the B Pink squad. The Australian at the back of the group, it's Sydney Uni Staminade.
Who's borrowed B Pink's pink socks?
They almost have matching jerseys.
They'll get down to a Tina section here at a roundabout, and they'll make a right-hand turn. Then they'll be alongside the beach in Torquay before they head through to the first of our intermediate sprints, which is 3.5 kilometres away. 3 points for the winner, 2 for second place, 1 for third place. Great opportunity for one of these two. If they can, obviously, they'll get the sprint here in Torquay. Then if they can hold on all the way through to series, which is with just 15.8 kilometres to go, one of them may well get themselves a moment in the spotlight at the podium presentation at the end of the race.
Undeservedly so. If that's to be the way it is, we've gone over 3 minutes a game. We've had about 3:10. The disruption has gone by now, so reclaiming the ground. They want really quite long turns, each pushing the pace. Give the other one chance to recover and then go back forward. They must work together with so far to go to the finish. 3 kilometres to the sprint. This looks like the outskirts of Torquay to me, Matt.
Yeah, this is the right-hand turn, and then it's onto the Esplanade, which takes them into the heart of Torquay. Famous for its many surf shops, Rip Curl having started here in Torquay, and it's grown significantly, Torquay, over the last 10 years. Is the peloton just cruising along as the two breakaway riders, Whitehouse at the front, Morzenti in second position, make the right-hand turn onto the Esplanade.
Nice crowd welcoming the two leaders now. They've come together in the last 2 kilometres. It's a really humid day today, as well as being quite warm now. It's supposed to hit a high of 30 degrees, which is about 94 degrees Fahrenheit, for those that can work it out.
And here's a look at where they are on the course map. Once they get through Torquay, they then head past number one Great Ocean Road as they head past the Torquay Golf Course. And then a little bit further along, they make a left-hand turn heading down towards Bells Beach for the first of the Subaru Queen of the Mountains points.
Yeah, that's a tough road, and that's where the whole situation could change when we get down towards Bell's Beats. But look how they pushed on here. Nearly half a minute gain in a kilometre.
Well, Mozenti is back pushing quite a high gear and lower cadence. It's working for her so far, but that will add to a bit of cumulative fatigue as they keep going. Georgia Whitehouse doesn't look quite as composed as she did earlier. Not surprising. It'll take her a bit of time to recover from that effort, both physically and emotionally. It can be quite rattling when something like that happens so unexpectedly out on course, especially when you're in a breakaway situation. But they're out to nearly 3.5 minutes. That's a solid gap. I can honestly say I did not expect the gap to get that far out. But it's a great animator for the race, because as this keeps going on, if these riders continue to move that advantage further out, it'll take some real aggression from back in the field from the big teams that everybody is watching. Oh, there's an elephant on a trailer.
And it's an African elephant as well, so it's a long way from
that
home.
That was just for you, Phil.
It must have been, yeah.
Based on the size of the ears, which are bigger than the Asian elephants.
Yes. But if these riders maintain their advantage or even grow it, Mitchelton, Scott, everybody will be looking to them to take up the chase. Also, Quartermaine, the real estate national team, with Kat Garfoot, Tiff Cromwell, Rachel Nalen, Loretta Hansen, Peter Mullins. They've got an incredible team. They will also be looked at to take some responsibility to bring this back.
Roughly 1,500 metres to go before they get to the intermediate sprint point. And the beach, the left-hand side, it's really calm, the waters at this point in Torquay. The beach for surfing is a little bit further around the corner, 1 kilometre to the sprint. Lawn Bowls off to the right-hand side.
I wonder
Cracker
if
Jack.
They'll sprint.
They will. No, they'll sprint. Absolutely, they'll sprint.
Because
even if they're out to a 5-minute gap, I'm backing the peloton to win. I don't see either of these riders standing any chance of surviving off the front, so they have to go for the intermediate sprint. This will be a serious battle.
Okay. We'll watch, won't we, Kate?
I think Whitehouse will be very motivated. Her team appear to be instructing her to go for this sprint. They both look a bit more fatigued than they did 10 kilometres ago. Not surprising. That's what happens throughout the bike race.
Tactical game already starting, Kate.
Yeah, Whitehouse won't take up responsibility for the pace. They're a little bit of cat and mouse here. That will be an advantage. But if the name of the game for Whitehouse and the Sydney Uni Staminade team is to get these points, then she's doing the right thing.
And this is smart by Whitehouse. She clearly is also of the view that they're not able to survive to the finish, and they're almost coming to a grinding halt. It's like a sprint on the track, Phil.
It is, and it's just losing time. So they're putting, as you said, a lot of credence on the sprint point. There's 1 point difference between
this
the two.
This is crazy.
This is
what
quite
we're
silly,
seeing.
Frankly.
Then rear wheel skid then from Mozenti, and now the sprint opens up. The Italian kicks hard for the line. This is a battle for 3 points in the race for the MAPI sprint prize. Whitehouse, who initiated the breakaway, she's trying to go around the outside. Mozenti is still holding on. Whitehouse is coming over the top, and it is Whitehouse who will get the points, and she'll take the lead in the race for the MAPI sprint prize. That was a big battle.
Well, I have to say, that's one of the most bizarre intermediate sprints in a road race that I've ever seen. I was going to say Georgia Whitehouse needed to lay off Mozenti a bit, because when you're sprinting from the back, you want to lay off and jump at them and not have it come to a standstill like that. It did end up playing in Whitehouse's favour, but that's very bizarre, and actually that's shattered the confidence that each will have in the other to push ahead as essentially teammates in this break. A little pat on the back. Let's get going again. Yeah, that was just plain old bizarre, Matt.
But very mature from the 20-year-old Italian, Mozenti, to get on with the job. Okay, we both understand the significance of that battle. Now let's start cooperating again.
Well, just looking from the helicopter here, which is about 1,000 feet up, maybe a little bit lower than that. Low cloud coming in. We had this problem yesterday. I had a helicopter flight yesterday. And, in fact, we couldn't fly over the bay because the cloud was extremely low with the heat.
It was from Gumbaya Park you made the trip from, wasn't it?
To and from Barwon Heads, yes.
You had the chance to watch Esteban Chavez go surfing.
Yeah, and grab a koala and play with a carpet python. Yeah, he didn't like snakes, by the way.
This is Gina Ricciardo in the pink colours of the Sydney Uni Staminade team. She'll be pretty pleased to hear that her teammate has managed to win the points out in front. The Japanese national champion up alongside her as well for the Wiggle High Five team. And that is Iri Yonamina.
There is still the third place points to be gained here. I don't expect them to be contested as hotly as if they were going for the first, second and third sprint, of course, but wouldn't surprise me to see Nettie Edmondson jump out of the pack and go for that, or even Chloe Hosking test her legs.
Here's another look at the sprint in the race for the MAPI sprint classification. One of the key moments, though, was the rear-wheeled skid from Morzenti to try and get Whitehouse to do the lead-out. But Whitehouse, she kept her cool. She stayed in the slipstream of the Italian, and then she calmly collected the points.
Quite a ding-dong battle for the sprint in the end. We knew that they'd be interested in contesting it and not just roll through as part of their breakaway. Possibly not how it didn't play out quite as we had imagined. But Georgia Whitehouse, well, she took a thumping victory there. Would have given her a lot of confidence and a great piece of recognition for the team. They've done a lot of hard work out there today.
And a super crowd too in Torquay. So all getting momentum for the men's race, which will come through here as well on Sunday. 3:35 the gap. They're sort of getting it back quite quickly. Could be a good sprint here for the third place, not knowing quite what will happen on the way through. There's three sprint points, which includes the actual finish. What's €50? Because that was the prize for winning that sprint.
Not a lot.
No, that's true. That hasn't helped at all, really.
No, around about 75 Australian dollars.
Enough to buy a round of coffees for everybody tomorrow morning after they go for their little recovery roll.
And just going through the front there, that intermediate sprint, it was a little bit difficult to tell from the aerial shot, but it certainly was a rider from the LA Cipollini team that was leading them through. I know who it wasn't. Roxanne Kenedelman, after that horrible fall that happened earlier on the road between Geelong and Barwon Heads.
Always disappointing to see riders felled, especially so early in a race, only 10 kilometres in. But it shows you have to be vigilant from kilometre one from the get-go. Now, two breakaway riders still working well together. Georgia Whitehouse with her hand in the air. Another flat tyre we're hearing. Gosh, she's had a day of very mixed fortunes with this breakaway, and now a second wheel change needed. Tell you what, I hope that it goes a bit more smoothly than the last one.
Asking for some ice.
I just heard from their team car a big sigh. Oh, her back tire's flat. I probably can't believe the day of misfortune's happening. She's taking some ice on board in the back of her jersey. Perhaps her tire isn't flat. She continues to ride on. And we haven't seen neutral service come up just yet, but that's something to watch. It's an indicator of how hot it is out on the road when she's putting and requesting ice down the back of her jersey.
I think she's getting herself into the unknown here now, Georgia Whitehouse. I think she's feeling the pace.
Well, the two leaders, they've made the left-hand turn. They're heading towards Bells Beach. They've gone through the first of the intermediate sprints. Let's now head down to Robbie McEwen.
Well, guys, I would estimate that this breakaway duo, I think they would have lost themselves around 30 to 40 seconds with that, what they call surplusen, before this sprint almost coming to a standstill. It was quite interesting to watch. But even the lack of organisation about even getting together, Georgia Whitehouse was off the front and actually spoke to her team director, who said, well, this really wasn't the plan. She was our designated protected rider, and she was to sit in and try on the circuit, but things have panned out differently. She went on the attack, but then she wasn't willing to wait for Morzenti to come across. She wanted to go to this sprint on her own. Then she was forced to, well, wait for an away with the puncture, which didn't go smoothly at all, as you would have seen. Now that they are together, they're finally starting to work properly together. But just a little while back, I did drop back in the convoy of the cars and have a very quick chat to the team director of Ale Cipollini. There's Fortunato Laquaniti, and he told me that Roxanne Kinnetterman also hit her head, so she's been taken to hospital with a concussion, and she'll be having some scans. But she was conscious and fine and talking, but she did hit her head quite hard as well.
Well, fingers crossed for Roxanne Kinnetterman. Robbie, back to that intermediate sprint. We've seen you involved in some vigorous ones, throwing headbutts to the likes of Baden Cook and Stuart O'Grady. But have you ever seen an intermediate sprint like that, where the breakaway almost came to a grinding halt?
No, I haven't. I've never myself come into an intermediate sprint going that slow. It was quite something to watch. It was like I was watching racing on the track with two full track sprinters trying to force each other to the front. But Georgia Whitehouse was clearly quicker. Good jump by Morzetti initially, but she did jump from around 300 metres to go. So Whitehouse just picked up that slipstream quite easily up and over the top. And I just saw her before when she dropped back to her team car. Huge grin and a big thumbs up. She's very happy that she got that intermediate sprint. And now they're starting to work smoothly together. The problem is they're now coming onto the hilly part of the course, up the hill out of Torquay, and pretty shortly they'll be turning left to drop down towards Bells Beach. A couple of those big roller coaster hills that'll really start to shorten them up. And then, of course, the first QOM, Queen of the Mountain of the Day. And I think that's where they'll start to struggle. But at the moment, they're putting everything into it and working smoothly together, finally.
Robbie, how does the wind look out on course? Because so far, we really haven't seen it play much of a role at all.
It's as good as non-existent, Kate. The wind is really so weak, and at times there is not a breath of wind. The good news out here at the moment, because we're right out next to the coast, that it is a little bit cooler. Earlier towards the start, back towards Geelong, it was almost 30 degrees. But now, if I look on the thermometer of the motorbike I'm sitting on, it's just ticked up to 27 because we've headed inland a little bit. Next to the water, it was only 25 degrees. So that is a little bit of relief for these riders.
Thanks, Robbie. We'll get back to you throughout the race as our two leaders are off the front with an advantage of 2 minutes and 50 seconds. The leaders are Georgia Whitehouse, the Australian riding for Sydney Uni Staminade, along with the Italian Lisa Morzenti, who rides for the B Pink team. Back in the peloton, everybody's still looking very calm and relaxed. And with those two riders out in front, I'm convinced the peloton are not concerned about them at all.
I think they'll implode on this series of rollers that we get now heading out through Bells Beach. I think Georgia, number 125, Georgia Whitehouse, is appearing good from behind, but if you see her face, I think she's pretty much into the red zone.
They're not far away from that Queen of the Mountain point at Bells Beach.
Look at the road, Matt. Look at this horrible road now. Oh, this will sap the strength.
It saps your morale, and then your strength follows.
It can be a bit demoralising, especially when the legs are hurting and the lungs are burning to look ahead and see that series of rollers. What it does give you is little pockets of recovery, because on those long, flat, false flat roads, you don't get a single moment's recovery. You stop pedaling for a second and you wipe out all your speed. So it will be some nice moments of recovery, but I'm afraid these little rollers will bite them on the other side. The kilometre 58 is where the QOM starts. So just a few K to go.
Quite smart there by the young Italian Morzenti, number 75. As they were over the big dippers, she did all she could to maintain that momentum before it started going uphill.
And Whitehouse is really starting to suffer a little bit. She's dropped down. She's in her drops. I'm not sure she's there for any other reason than she's starting to hurt a bit. She'll be enjoying the recovery on these downhill sections, but that recovery will be short-lived as they nip up this next little roller before they head on to quite a challenging first KOM.
This one's a lot more difficult than the previous one that they went over. This one goes for around about 500 metres, the next one that they hit, and they'll be down onto the small chain ring pretty soon. This is a nasty little climb.
Well, they've done an exceptional job so far to stay out, get the advantage out to 3.5 minutes. It's back just below 2.5 minutes now. It's definitely coming back. If they can survive to the KOM, which I think they will, the QOM, then I think after that we're going to see the peloton in view very quickly. The peloton will climb up that QOM significantly quicker than this breakaway. They're quite fatigued after being out there for quite a number of clicks now. Georgia Whitehouse still maintaining the pace. They're both suffering a bit. The body language, you can see, Phil, look at that bouncing, ducking shoulders from the Italians starting to hurt. Yep.
It is. And when they cross the QOM at the top, they are precisely half distance in the race. So you see, still an awful long way to go.
that in itself, I think, will be slightly demoralising. You can actually see on Whitehouse's head stem that she has the course mapped out there with all the indicators written there, so she'll know exactly how far it is to go. You can see those rollers up ahead of the peloton. They're still not moving too quickly, but naturally their speed down and up will be faster than the breakaways.
Number one and number two, former winners of the race, Annemiek van Vleuten and Amanda Spratt, sitting relaxed, comfortable at the rear of the peloton.
They're just hanging out back there. They don't need to worry too much now. They just need to pay a little bit of attention in the case that any attacks do go over the QOM from any riders of any danger. But they'll have one or two Mitchelton Scott riders at the front patrolling and ensuring that if any movements are made, that they are represented.
Seeing them at the back tells us a big part of the story of the day, the lack of wind. If it was windy, they wouldn't be sitting down towards the back because that's the danger zone. But when it's as calm as it is today, they can afford to relax towards the back, almost at the top of the hill. There's the crest just in front of them. They make a left-hand turn, then they sweep down along the right with Bells Beach, famous Bells Beach, off to the left-hand side, and then they start the vicious Queen of the Mountain climb.
Well, as we can see from the course profile and the elevation, the first half of the race is the easy part. So they've got quite a number of rollers and climbs to go. This first QOM is only the very beginning of that. And whether the athletes animate the race through their tactics and aggressive attacks, it doesn't really matter. I think there's a lot of natural selection that happens just by way of the course. It's very self-selective, Phil.
Well, you can see the roller coasters here now. We're going into the hilly sector of the whole race. It all happens in the last 50% of the course, and the peloton know this, and yet they've never allowed this breakaway to get more than just over 3.25 minutes. So there's no way they can stay away to the finish.
60 kilometres remaining. The Queen of the Mountain point after they go past Bells Beach, that's at 56.6 kilometres to go. So they are approaching that point. If they were to make the left-hand turn in a few hundred metres, they'd be into the car park down to Bells Beach. Back of the peloton, number 136, who you can see out of the saddle. That's Peter Mullins for the Cordamenta Real Estate team. Australian national squad. Peter herself, a former Australian road champion. She's got one of the big favourites for the race today. Katrin Garfoot, along with Lauren Kitchen. Also a former winner of the race on that team, Rachel Nalan. Kate, at what point do the teams that don't have a really quick sprinter, but they think they've got one of the favourites, at which point do they start to really light the action up?
Well, I think now that we're heading into the second half of the race, the self-selective course will play in their favour a lot. They do need to start applying a lot of pressure over all of these little rollers. It'll certainly make a very big impact just on reducing the field to a more manageable size. In years past, we've seen the group come back down to about 20 or 30 riders, which means that the big teams with the higher numbers certainly have a much higher advantage. For now, the breakaway is still hanging on. They've got a couple of minutes up their sleeve, but that is being reduced fairly quickly. Peloton starting to string out. They've picked the pace up a little bit. They will see the QOM as a big turning point. It's the halfway mark in the race. It's also the mark that says the course is getting a little bit more difficult. We saw Kate Perry just hanging out at the back before. She's one of the best domestic climbers we have, riding for Specialized Women's Racing. They have a great collaboration this year, Matt, with Black Sheep, an Australian-based clothing company that do some really funky stuff. And together, they've worked hard at really building the team up that next level. All the riders exceptionally well supported, and they've got some great staff that elevate them to the level of an international team, even though currently they're only a domestic one.
They do have a very strong team. Look out for Kendall Hodges, Taryn Heather, and also Kate McElroy from that Specialised Women's Racing team. And Kate Perry, who Kate had just mentioned. There's Bells Beach off to the left-hand side. And Juan Antonio Fletcher, the great Spanish cyclist who was a stage winner at the Tour de France back in 2003. He's down here for the Cadel Evans Great Ocean Road Race. It's his first visit, much to my surprise, to Australia. Has never ridden the Tour Down Under. But when we see him at the compound at the Tour de France, we see him just scooting through the compound on his skateboard. He didn't bring his skateboard with him, but he did hire a surfboard, and he went and ventured into the waves at Bells Beach just yesterday.
He's not afraid of the sharks, it appears.
No. He really did enjoy himself, and it's great to have Juan Antonio Fletcher with us at this year's Cadel Evans Great Ocean Road Race. There's the car park down at the beach. which is a hub of activity on the Labor Day weekend in early March for the Rip Curl Classic.
Now, you see, looking at this row from a helicopter, if it had been hostile weather today, this field would have just split up all over the place. As it is, they're waiting for these roller coaster hills. When they go over these roller coaster, it's not so much the pace is on, it's a lot of the women at the back simply aren't up to the effort, and being the driving at the front is hurting.
It felt like there was a little bit of movement within the peloton on that occasion, Kate, as these are the numbers for the climb. Maximum gradient of 18%, 2 kilometres in length, but a few in the peloton that have been sitting at the back figure, not sure what's going to happen up here past Bells Beach. I bet it'd be near the front.
As Phil mentioned, there's two ways in which races break up. A breakaway goes off the front, or the pace is just consistent enough that a lot of riders start dropping off the back. If you're a rider that is a good climber, you don't want to be anywhere near the riders who aren't, because for every time they drop a wheel, which is to say lose some contact and lose some distance from the wheel in front of them, it means you have to put in that extra effort to rejoin and to bridge, and it's completely wasted energy. Strategically, it's just not very on point, and they need to be very careful about that. The riders with more experience, we will see them jostling and moving up. It's quite difficult. We can see the peloton spread the entire way across the road here, so it's tough to move up. It's not about pace. It's simply about, you know, are you willing to stick your elbow into somebody to get through? That's how accidents happen on the edge of these roads with no gutters. You have to really, well, it's not quite taking your life into your hands, but you have to be pretty gutsy and take a deep breath and decide that it's worth it. This is the time when it is, because once they hit that climb, gradients up to 18%, that's pretty solid. It may only average 6%, but you don't want to get caught out on an 18% part, dropping a wheel and dropping some pace. The breakaway is on the climb now. A minute 40 ahead, I expect over the top that will be reduced further and further. I think the peloton will just eat into that as they go up this climb. It lasts a couple of kilometres before they hit that QOM.
This is the fourth edition of the Deakin University Cadel Evans Great Ocean Road Race. 2 litres, they've been off the front for quite a while now. They made their move just on the outskirts of Barwon Heads. Sitting at the back of the group, number 125, that's the Australian Georgia Whitehouse. She won the intermediate sprint in Torquay. The young Italian, the 20-year-old who celebrated her birthday just 3 days ago, Lisa Morzenti from the B Pink team, is the one who's setting the tempo out in front. Off in the distance, that's the Queen of the Mountain point in the race for the Subaru Queen of the Mountains jersey. 500 metres until they get there. A little bit of a dip before they hit the climb proper. Completely different complexion to the race from what we've seen in the first 3 editions of the Deakin University Cadel Evans Great Ocean Road Race, where the wind has been a factor. It hasn't today. So that will make the final closing on the last climbs towards Geelong even more explosive. How tactical will this climb be? The sprint was tactical.
Well, Morzenti certainly showed her acceleration when they went to nearly snail's pace. They nearly stopped dead. It's the most bizarre thing I've seen in an intermediate sprint. Robbie McEwen too, I'm glad that he also backed that up and said we haven't seen anything like it. On the climb, well, gosh, I think they'll be going snail's pace simply because of the gradient of the climb. But Georgia Whitehouse, I reckon she'll be going for the points, Matt, because
She wants the points, and now she goes. Georgia Whitehouse, she makes her move. Can Morzenti respond? No, the Italian does not have the answers. So one of the riders from the Sydney Uni Staminate team that was designated to be a protected rider, she ignored those early instructions. She's got herself into the breakaway. She's won the intermediate sprint in Torquay. She wins the Queen of the Mountains points at Bells Beach, but the peloton now is really closing in and a minute and 9 seconds behind. Whitehouse collecting 3 points in the race for the Subaru Queen of the Mountains classification, and she's almost spent all her biscuits.
Yeah, she looks cooked like a roast dinner. That was a lot of effort. Important for their team tactics. I think that it's fair to assume that they would not have survived too much further. So for Whitehouse, it was important to get those points.
And in the race for the Subaru Queen of the Mountains jersey, on this climb, 3 points for the win. But on Shalamba Crescent, it's 5 points for the win. So who wins that Queen of the Mountains jersey? It's more likely to come down to that final climb.
I've been really impressed to see the domestic talent step up and make the international field pay attention. It certainly animated the race so far. The peloton, they don't look like they're making too many attacks. The gradient of the climb, Phil, will just naturally self-select. Some riders will drop off the back, but there's no attacks going up here and no team taking responsibility for it.
No, and the tail is very tidy of this peloton, so there's nobody really under pressure either, which I'm a little bit surprised on this climb. I thought there were quite a few weak riders down there. Seemingly not. One more place to come on the Queen of the Mountains. Incidentally, Roxanne Kinnett, when we saw fourth my bike, the latest news from the hospital is she's in a stable condition, but she's passing in and out of consciousness, so they're just trying to stabilise her, but it's basically good news at the moment.
That was number 61, Eva Berman from the Netherlands. She's gone across the top of that Queen of the Mountains points to collect the third place. That gives her 1 point in the race for the Subaru Queen of the Mountains classification.
Well, this breakaway is shattered now. Morzenti struggled up the QOM, but now it's Georgia Whitehouse who is paying the price for that effort. They're no longer a twosome, Phil. They're just one after the other.
Yeah.
This will get swallowed up fairly quickly from the peloton.
Yeah, the Italian up front here, she's been beaten to second place twice. So they're not really helping each other. And at the minute 14, it won't be long before they decide to pick them up. They may just leave them out there to fry for a bit longer.
It's a cruel little game they play, isn't
it? Oh, it's a nasty sport.
And unfortunately for the two leaders who have really made the race so far, if they do get reeled in within the next 15 kilometres or so, which I suspect they probably will, they won't make it to the intermediate sprint in series to try and collect that MAPI sprint classification, and they certainly won't survive until the climb of Chilamba Crescent. So I fear for Georgia Whitehouse, number 125, she'll finish in second place in each of those classifications.
But I have to give her a very big high five for her efforts today. At
Agreed.
The beginning of the race, we did not, it was not a name we expected to be one of the major protagonists early on. So well done to her and the team. And I hope that her teammates have been taking advantage of the hard work, sitting back, resting their legs so that when the break does come back, that they will still be able to be represented. When some of the bigger teams, Mitchelton Scott and Quartermantha Real Estate National Team, they're the riders that we expect over the more difficult second half of the race.
Here's a look at the Subaru Queen of the Mountains sprint between Whitehouse, number 125, and Morzenti, number 75. It was the Australian again who took that second spot, so she kept her rival within her sights. The move came on the right-hand side, and Morzenti didn't have any answer to Whitehouse, who has collected 3 points in the race for the Queen of the Mountains classification. 3 points for her, 2 points then for Morzenti, and 1 point for Berman. Our two leaders now find themselves at just over 1 minute ahead of the peloton, and they've got themselves working together once again as we're inside the last 55 kilometres in the fourth edition of the Deakin University Cadel Evans Great Ocean Road Race.
One minute 10, 70 seconds now, that's all it is. But at least we've spoken about two women we've never spoken about before, and they've taken the race to the superstars today, who haven't been able to make a move. Their names are well known to the rest of the peloton, and it's been due to the conditions, very calm conditions, the calmest I have ever seen here, and this is the fourth year of this event. They're going to stick to the guns for the moment, because very often they start to close in. Now we're over the climb, there's always a chance they'll be allowed to run again. But the next sprint point is 15 kilometres from the finish, and the next climb is only 9 kilometres from the finish. It's unlikely they'll hit those two spots.
They really are toying with them now. The brake's gone slightly out again. The peloton has completely taken the foot off the accelerator after they went over that QOM. We saw a few gaps appearing, but the riders are dropping back now to get some drinks and some food before they get in earnest into the back end of the race. They have passed through the halfway mark, and we can see three Sydney Uni Staminade riders just sitting at the back there, definitely taking advantage of the hard work being done out the front by teammate Georgia Whitehouse.
Tipco colours just rolling off the front as we see the rider with the blue helmet on in the Quarter Mentha Real Estate Australian National Team colours. That is Loretta Hansen. She's the youngest member of that Australian national team. She's not a rider that I expect to get the opportunity to race for herself today, as we just get confirmation for the Bells Beach Kikwina, the Mountains Point. And it was Alice Cobb, in fact, that went over the top in third position. She'd broken clear of the peloton to collect those points. It was Berman that led the peloton over the top from the Trek Drops team, but it was the rider from the Tipco team, and actually that was out in front. Our cameras just, unfortunately, hadn't quite picked it up. Alice Cobb of Great Britain taking the 1 point there.
And for Tipco, both the woman and the team, never been here before. So they found the way to Bells Beach. That's where we are at the moment. We've come away from Bells Beach now. We're starting to go inland as we turn towards Geelong. Not an easy road now, virtually until we get to the outskirts of the city. And, of course, very difficult, just 9 kilometres out from the finish, up Chelambra Crescent, which is a brute of a climb. And that is probably the reason why the main field has not reacted to these two. 78 seconds. So they've pushed on again. They're trying to recover, though, the best part of 2.5 minutes.
I've been really impressed with number 75, who's just 20 years of age, one of the youngest in the race, Morzenti. She's been in second position at the sprint in Torquay, the Queen of the Mountain at Bells Beach. But each time after that, she has been the one that's got them organised again and continuing to try and hold on to what really is a very slender lead, a minute and 21 seconds.
Not afraid of reputation at all. She was the first woman to attack. She attacked some 9 kilometres into the race. They let her dangle, then they came out and got her. Then she came across to the leader, Whitehouse, on her own. A little bit surprised how she caught her, because Whitehouse was standing on the roadside with a problem. But they've got back together again.
It's been, just for the breakaway riders, for Georgia Whitehouse, quite an animated day, mixed fortunes. She's had a flat tyre, she's spent a lot of kilometres solo, she's gotten a QOM title, she's gotten a sprint title. She might lose them through the points accumulated at the next two. But for now, they're still surviving. The gap's going out further. We're playing a few games, the peloton, with the Matt.
Two ways to take a look at the gap. One, with the Tag Heuer, 1 minute and 26 second gap. Or we can take advantage of the chopper and take a look at the gap. And it's the old cliche in cycling, Kate, on a road like this, there's nowhere to hide. So the peloton, whether they can see the 128 or not, what the gap is, they can see the cars behind the breakaway. Well, they know they've got them under control.
That's a beautiful shot. It gives a really good perspective of the distance. It's quite hard to visualise what a minute and a half looks like. Well, there you go. There you have it on one long open road. The peloton can just see them up there. They're toying with them. But the breakaway have done a tremendous job, and they're kicking on. They're not giving up. It's easy for us to sit here in commentary and say that they have no chance. Ladies, you've done an excellent job. We don't take away from that. We just know how incredibly difficult it is in these circumstances with a peloton that will soon be starting to pay a little bit more attention and focus to the break.
They're on the Great Ocean Road at the moment, but they're about to make the right-hand turn at this roundabout. If they had have gone off to the left and stuck with the Great Ocean Road, they'd be eventually down into Anglesey and then further along into Lawn, onto the likes of Wye River and Kennet River, before getting all the way down to Apollo Bay and eventually onto the famous 12 Apostles, which are down to around about 6.5 apostles now with corrosion. But it is a stunning place to visit. And if you do get the opportunity to come down to the Surf Coast, make the journey further along the Great Ocean Road. It's one of the most spectacular drives or rides you could ever imagine to do.
Couldn't agree with you more there, Matt. It's the most beautiful ride. But it's not flat if you're thinking of taking a bicycle. It's quite hilly.
Oh, no. The great Phil Anderson lives down towards the end of the road in Apollo Bay. And I can recall one time doing a ride along the Great Ocean Road about 20 kilometres away from where Phil Anderson lives. And here comes some guy running up the road with a dog alongside him. And it was the almost 60-year-old Phil Anderson. Turnaround point would have made for a 40K run. He's not slowing down.
No, he's not slowing down. He's a tremendous athlete. Was the first yellow jersey wearer of the Tour de France for Australia. And my only problem going out with Phil on the bike, he never stops talking. and it's very difficult for me to talk on the Great Ocean Road.
The art of a bike ride with Phil Anderson is ask short questions that require really long answers.
Yes, well, he asks long questions and gets no answer in my case.
Now the peloton about to make the right-hand turn. They're very content, aren't they, Kate?
Well, in usual circumstances, when they take this right-hand turn, they're heading into a crosswind, and this has been their small chance to recover before it gets tough. They're not up against that today, half their luck.
Look at those trees, not moving at all.
Not an inch of wind out there. Matilda Reynolds are riding as a guest rider here for Holden Team Gusto. She's sitting on the front. She's reasonably new to cycling. She comes from a triathlon background. She's a very successful triathlete, so it's a very wise, very smart choice by the Holden team to have her on board. She will do great things for that team, but Grace Brown is the rider to watch for them. Brody Chapman, another young up-and-coming rider, incredibly talented. We saw over the summer and at the national championships, she really made her mark and put her name up there. That's the great thing about the Aussie summer, Matt, is that we get to see this young talent really taking the next step up. This summer's been wonderful for it. Shannon Mulseed has been another one. Grace Brown, Brody Chapman, all these names that 12 months ago probably weren't on the list of potential race winners, but they are this year.
All those riders that you just mentioned with connections to the Holden Team Gusto squad, which we can see them now on the front. It's the black colours with the red on the sleeve. That's Reynolds, who's at the front, one of the guest riders on this team. For the last 2 years, they've won the National Road Series. And last year, it was Shannon Mulseed who managed to take out that title. It was Lisa Hoskins the year before that. It's an impressive team that develops young riders in the same manner that we're seeing with what is now known as the Bennelong team, the old Avanti team, the team that Richie Port came through. The Holden Gusto team is doing exactly the same for women's cycling.
Well, and Holden have an incredible footprint in women's sport, actually, across cycling, across the AFL. They've really stepped up to provide some equal opportunities for women in sport in Australia, and we have to really applaud them for that effort. And it's great to see a domestic team really mixing it with the internationals.
There were two red bottles on the bike before, but she's down to one as our leader, Georgia Whitehouse, is continuing to gnaw away, keep the calories and the fluids going in. And this is the woman that's keeping her company. This is Monzenti, the young Italian.
To a degree, these two have recovered, you know. They're looking a lot better facially. They're not making the same expressions. They've got a nice rhythm going. And Whitehouse hasn't increased her cadence. She's still settled down. Gap is being absolutely pinned at around about 90 seconds, and we are 1 hour and 10 minutes from the finishing line, which will put us absolutely on the schedule the organisers expected. So everything will go in according to plan just now.
Well, the peloton has stepped up the pace. We've seen some attacks here. We've got four riders riding off the front. Number 63, we can see there, is Annesley Park, rider number 46, Holly Breck, and they are joining two riders at the front. Number 33, Anna Trevisi from the Arle Cipollini team, and Barbara Garisi from Virtue Cycling. I expected Virtue to play a bigger role early on in the race in being aggressive. She was one of the first to attack, but they've been neutralised by that breakaway a little bit. But look at what's happening here. The chase is on in earnest. Yep. They're not even letting a small group jump away now.
Bill, this is the next phase of the race.
Yeah, they've almost metronomes because they realise they're 50 kilometres out. Time to bring it down, and they've got themselves organised just a little bit. A lot of head turning now to see who has reacted quickly to this, because the names that we would expect to see making the final moves, like Van Vleuten, Spratt, Malseed, perhaps Edmondson, will wait till the very last moment, but Katrin Garfoot may not. Just checking their locations, so I can't see them.
Those bright colours are the LA Cipollini team, Kate. They are marking the moves. They did this on the road in the Barwon Heads. They've marked them again as they head down Forest Road. They're trying to keep the race calm for Chloe Hosking. Chloe is noted as a sprinter. People run the risk of underestimating Chloe when there's a climb, like there is towards the end of the race today. She's been top five in this race before, and you do not want to go to a sprint finish with Chloe Hosking in contention.
Oh, goodness, no. Chloe is She's very fit. She's looking very firmly toward the Commonwealth Games, which, of course, we'll see free and live on Channel 7 here. Just in about 8 weeks' time, and Chloe has her preparation nailed for that. She can definitely get over the climat. I mean, it's a matter for how the race goes into that. Look at some beautiful hay bale decorations. Where are we, Victoria or the south of France?
This is wonderful. Anglesey, beautiful spot. I like the hay bale and the bike that has been put together nicely with the old milk crates. Not a particularly aerodynamic position. Looks excellent. More like a mountain bike.
That would rival anything the Tour de France has to offer, that one. A little bit wide handlebars, but we'll get away with it.
White House. From the Sydney Uni Staminae team, sitting at the back. She's now eaten both those tubes that were sitting on the top tube. No, she's still got one left, one to go. Late lunch, Morzenti in second position. They'll be hearing about the reactions coming from the peloton, but they cannot do anything about it. ...52 kilometres left to race.
Well, that's what the clock says, Matt, but it seems to have stopped. We've been 52 kilometres for quite a long time now. Not good news for the two up front.
And the next of the intermediate sprints, that's in series with just on 16 kilometres to go. Then the major obstacle of the day, the big opportunity for the non-sprinters, Jalamba Crescent, which comes, well, it starts with 10Ks to go. And there's a big change, 46.9 kilometres to go. So, Phil, time has jumped forward all of a sudden.
Good news for the two ladies up front. A minute 25 the gap. It's been held, though, at the same time virtually. So at the moment, it really is a case of cat and mouse here.
And the pace has eased off again. In the peloton, nobody yet ready to take responsibility for the pace. I must say, I'm surprised at how patient these major teams are being. I expected a flurry of attacks to come through this section of the course. They're playing into the hands of the likes of Chloe Hosking. She can definitely get over the Jalamba Crescent climb if the pace is easy enough leading in and allows her to get there with fresh enough legs. Based on what we're seeing here, I'm going Team Chloe Hosking if this continues. Mitchelton Scott, they do have a lot of options, as do the Quartermet, the Real Estate National team.
Speaking of that team, I've hardly spotted Katrin Garfoot.
Well, that's a good thing.
She is there, and the team, the Quartermet Australian National team, are on the left of the right of the road. So they've got the whole field cornered here. We won't get any indication until we get to the big climb towards the end of Jalamba. That is, who survives that will decide the race. I'm not sure whether Chloe Hosking can survive that climb.
It's kind of 6-1, half dozen to the other at the moment, Phil. Yeah. We're just waiting to see what happens and who takes responsibility. What I can quite confidently say is the RLA Cipollini won't be forcing any breaks. I think that they will be vigorously chasing any to try and keep it Gruppo Compatto, but I don't think that they'll be forcing the break. Protecting their sprinter requires quite different tactics than trying to win in a breakaway. Georgia Whitehouse and Lisa Morzenti are certainly still giving it their best. The break hasn't really come back at all since that minute and a half mark.
The fluoro helmets at the front of the TIBCO team, the teammates of Shannon Molsey. She's the current Australian road champion. In the race, as we get a chance to pan back and take a look at the gap between our two leaders, Whitehouse from the Sydney Uni Staminae team, who's joined forces a long time ago now with Morzenti from B Pink. Minute and 30 seconds, the peloton can see it. Multiple Australian champions or former Australian champions in the peloton. One of them who we haven't really spoken about so far today is Gracie Elvin. She's been the dual Australian champion, second in the Tour of Flanders last year. And she doesn't necessarily have a major protected status on this team this year because she's got the defending champion, Van Vleuten, the previous winner, Amanda Spratt. But Gracie Elvin is another rider everybody else has to watch.
Absolutely right. I was actually with her yesterday and she had a place to play, but they made a bit of a mess of the finish in Albert Park. She led out the rider, but the rider wasn't on her wheel. However, today could be for her. She's very confident.
Here's Amanda Spratt back to the team car. Stocking full of ice, perhaps, by the looks of it, to stick that down the back of the jersey to try and stay cool.
Amanda's got a little bandage on her elbow there. Don't know if she came down earlier. We never saw it, did we?
That was from the final stage of the Santos Tour Down Under.
Okay, cool. Oh, yes, of course, in the run-up to the finishing line there in the middle of the race. She was very lucky. She won the race nonetheless.
Well, the riders do have race radio, but nothing quite beats face-to-face communication. She's getting a musette full of bottle and food there to take up to her teammates. Interesting that one of the more protected riders would actually be doing that, but she does head out on course as captain on the road of the team, having a chat to Jean Bates in the car about tactics. I suggest she will head up and one by one dot through the field, pick up her riders and say, let's go.
They're only about 10 kilometres, perhaps less, from going through Moriac and the official feed zone. If you can take advantage of the calmness in the peloton at this point and not have to worry about the stress of the feed zone, that puts you in a better chance to be able to attack pretty quickly once they get out the other side of that feed.
Well, feed zones can be quite a messy thing, but it looks like she might actually have a pack of ice there. She's popping a big thing. What they actually do, they fill the ends of stockings, they cut the legs off stockings and fill them with ice and put them down the back of their jersey to cool themselves down. We're looking at the temperature gauge in here. It's not that hot out on course for what we think, but the fact that the riders are cooling down, it's the second rider we've seen now with ice down their jersey, it does indicate that the conditions out on course are possibly a bit more challenging than what we can appreciate looking at these pictures and the temperature gauge.
I think it's extremely humid. This reminds me of Malaysia and the races we do there in the month of February. Very humid indeed today. Perhaps more pleasant for the cyclists and the spectators in many ways because they do have a little cooling breeze which they create themselves. 44 kilometres, approximately 1 hour of racing left for these women. Might get slowed a little bit with the climb, 9 kilometres out from the finish. And they are just doing what they have to do. There's Robbie McEwen chatting away.
Robbie is ready to go. Robbie, it's down to you.
Well, guys, I can confirm that it has got hotter now. We've moved away from the ocean. That pleasant 25 degrees through Torquay and Bells Beach has now turned to a rather steamy and uncomfortable 32 degrees along Forest Road here. And there's just no breeze getting in here because in that forest, it's like riding through a tunnel. There have been a couple of skirmishes, as you've seen, but no really concerted efforts to bring this break back. They're pretty comfortable where they are. What I'm seeing is teams starting to look a little more organised and a little more interested in starting to place themselves at the front, get some chasing done. I'm seeing Kendall Ryan from the TIBCO team rode so well in the race towards zero a couple of days ago. But I think TIBCO, they may be inspired by the attack that was made earlier by Alice Cobb, the young Brit, over the QOM. She was really impressive up that steeper section. She's so slightly built, very, very small and a pure climber. So they may be starting to think she has a good chance once they get to the circuits. Also now making an appearance to the front on the left is Katrin Garfoot, probably the big race favourite and not in one of the big race teams. But we all know how good she is and she's been a world medalist over the last couple of years, road race and time trial. And a lot of eyes are fixed on her because the big word on the street is she will attack on Chalambra and try and go solo. So that's what a lot of riders are concentrating on. But at the moment, it's again the calm before the storm. Even the Mitchelton riders at the moment handing drinks and food around, having a chat, a smile. They're pretty relaxed. Amanda Spratt on the right, Gracie Elvin just there as well. Sarah Roy just behind them. So still relaxed in the peloton, but I can feel the tension starting to build.
Robbie, with that comment in mind about Katrin Garfoot and wanting to attack on Chalamba Crescent, do you feel the need for the Quartermentha real estate team to heat the action up before they get there?
I think it will be in Katrin's interest to have the race as hard as possible before they get there. But not split to pieces, so not jumping down the road and trying to form breakaways, but just making it hard at every opportunity. But, you know, they will need to cover a lot because there are teams like Mitchelton Scott who have the power in numbers. Where we talk about Katrin Garfoot being so good, I'm not sure they can match it as a team overall against the might of Mitchelton Scott. And I'm sure Annemiek van Vleuten is also watching Garfoot very closely and could well be planning a move of her own, because she doesn't have to sit and wait for anyone else. After all, she's Annemiek van Vleuten.
Thanks, Rob. As we look down to the Wiggle High Five team, this is Barbieri, the Italian on that squad. And Phil, she's loading up with the Biddens. She's got the team domestic duties.
And now the problem of getting it all back to the other women on the team, because those Biddens are heavy. And she probably has got five at least in her pockets now to deliver. And we've got similar going on here. This is Molly Weaver, the British rider on Trek. having a chat. She hangs on to that car much longer. They will penalise her for that.
And, Kate, we're seeing a lot of teams at this point, only a matter of kilometres away from the official feed zone, sending riders back to the team cars, making the most of this, as Robbie called it, the calm before the storm. It can be dangerous through the feed zone.
It can be dangerous through the feed zone, but what we're also seeing is this collection of ice. And that's something that they can't really pick up at the feed zone because, for the most part, they will just simply be grabbing water bottles. And so they are getting a lot of this ice to cool down. This is interesting. She really is hanging on the
car. I'll tell you, if the commissaire saw that, he would probably disqualify.
Did you just hear race radio? Race radio just said, Trek drops. It's imperative that the rider pedals the bicycle.
Yep, absolutely
that
right.
That is an official, unofficial warning.
Well, if she's holding onto a water bottle, we'd call it a sticky bidden. But she wasn't. She was just hanging onto the car. So a sticky bidden of sorts, perhaps.
Too blatant.
Yeah.
Specialised women's racing team starting to line up at the front there. They've got some great climbers in that team. Kate McElroy, she's been world mountain running champion. She's been to the Olympics for the triathlon for New Zealand. She's a great climber. She'll be looking up Shalambra. Oh, it's good. This is our breakaway and our chasing peloton right here. A bit of wildlife.
The two up front are on a different team to the peloton, that's for sure.
As we pan back down towards the peloton and the convoy of cars, plenty of riders in the convoy of cars collecting water bottles, taking the ice on as well. They've been racing now for a little bit over 2 hours in the fourth edition of the Deakin University Cadel Evans Great Ocean Road Race. We have two riders off the front, Lisa Morzenti, number 75, along with number 125, Georgia Whitehouse from the Sydney Uni Staminade team.
I tell you what, Matt, this race is going to be incredible on that climb. Because there's so many believe now that they can win this race because they're still in the pack. The pressure has not been applied all day long. We're talking now hot temperatures now, 32 degrees, high humidity, and until they get to the climb, we won't know who is going for it.
Here's one of the contenders, the Australian national champion. Left-hand side of the screen, the yellow across the shoulders, the green and gold bands around the chest as well. Shannon Molseed, yeah. She's really stepped up in the past 12 months and she's a genuine threat to win today.
Well, until now, it's looked like the peloton hasn't been going all that fast. From the average speed, we can see they're ticking along. Shannon Molseed there in the Tibco colours, the national champion stripe, number 51. So resplendent in the champion colours, but they're actually not working too hard now. Molseed isn't even pedalling at the moment.
And Phil, superstition among cyclists. We've seen Fabian Cancellara so often put number 13 upside down. How would Shannon Molseed feel about number 51 if she knows the history of that number?
Well, she should feel very proud because you don't choose your number before you ride a bike race. And yet 51 has won the Tour de France more times than any other number, except number one, of course, for the defending champion. And with Lance Armstrong losing his 7 titles, that meant 6 times he rode with number one on, the odds may have come down somewhat.
Speaking of number one, here is the world's number one cyclist. This is Annemiek van Vleuten. She's the second oldest in the race, and she's a rider with plenty of experience, but she's still right in the sweet spot of her career. World champion in the time trial last year. She was also part of that strong Dutch team that delivered the rainbow jersey to the Netherlands as well. Won this race, the Giro Rosa, the Le Course by the Tour de France. What a season it was. And she's hard to go past as a winner of today's race.
I quite agree. I think her catching Garfoot, I think it'll be a bit too hard for Shannon Molseed. All the answers will come 9 kilometres out from the finish for the first selection. And then we'll see how they go down to the line on what is a beautiful day on the Esplanade, because that's where we're commentating from in the city of Geelong.
They're continuing still along Forest Road. Here are our two leaders at the front. This is Whitehouse. In second position is Morzenti. Whitehouse, she's picked up the points in Torquay for the Mapei Sprint Prize. She also picked them up in Bells Beach for the Subaru Queen of the Mountains. And Morzenti, her birthday just a few days ago, she's in much better form than what she showed at the Tour Down Under. And Kate, all of a sudden, her advantage, just inside 40 kilometres to go, is back out over 3 minutes.
Well, their pace has just continued to grow and to be steady. We thought that over the QOM they'd lose a bit of time. They did. We didn't expect it to go back out. We thought the peloton would be a little bit more diligent in chasing it back and bringing it back. A lot of waiting and looking and watching going on from the peloton heading toward the back end of the race.
Number 131 for the Quartamenta real estate team. This is Katrin Garfoot. And there has not been a single rider that I've asked in the past 48 hours as to who the favourites are that has not mentioned Katrin Garfoot.
She's cool as a cucumber, just sitting in the middle, protecting herself and not working too hard. Certainly if it comes down to a bunch of whatever size going up to that Chalamba Crescent climb, it's hard to go past Katrin Garfoot. She's got a lot on the line this year, and it's for her, she's achieved some tremendous things in the sport. But to be able to stand atop the podium at a Commonwealth Games, a home Commonwealth Games for her, since she's Australian from the Gold Coast, I think that's very important to her. She's certainly laying down the pavement for the success of that.
Last year, Katrin Garfoot at the World Championships, she collected the bronze medal in the individual time trial. I think it was 18 seconds behind Annemiek van Vleuten. And then in the sprint for second place at the World Championships, she brought home the silver medal. What a performance.
Yeah, she's amazing, right? She's achieved an awful lot. She came into the sport quite late as well. And now she's concentrating here in Australia, 36 years of age. So she's reaching the end of her career. She'd love to go out on a high note in April in Brisbane. But right now, we will see her attack. There's no question. It's only a question of when and where.
We can see Team Virtue Cycling grouping at the front there. We've expected them to be a bit more antagonistic in the race today than we've seen so far. But it is an indicator with four of the riders up the front there, headed by Linda Willemsen, the former world time trial champion, that they perhaps have something on their mind to start making a move. Or, Phil, they're aware that the other teams may be making a move too pretty soon, and they want to be a part of that. This breakaway is still riding a steady pace up the front. They have opened that gap back out toward the three-minute mark. I'm not sure either of those riders would have expected it to go back out to there, but you've got to make the most of it. They're riding comfortably. They do look more comfortable than they did 20, 30-odd kilometres ago.
And they might be holding out hope that they can survive to series, which is at 15.6 kilometres to go.
Winner takes all.
And the next of the intermediate sprints.
Yeah. Absolutely right.
And if this woman, Whitehouse, can collect the 3 points there, as she did in Torquay, she has an unassailable lead.
She believes she can now, but it's still a tough call. That's a 15 kilometres from the finish, so still a long way to go there. She's been in the lead now for over 55 kilometres, and then she was joined a few K into the attack by Lisa Mazzenti.
We can see the Mitchelton-Scott riders are starting to group. The bright yellow shoulders on the black jerseys and the yellow helmets. They're starting to group and move further toward the front.
Race radio giving an update on the time gap. 1 minute and 49 seconds, they're saying now. So that's a dramatic drop from the three-minute time check that we saw just a few moments ago.
Something not quite right there, I think, Matt. But these women haven't tried to bring them back. They're still controlling their own race here, waiting for the terrain, change of direction perhaps, or indeed the climb of the Chalabra.
We haven't seen a sprinter win on this course yet. Rachel Nayland, Amanda Spratt and Annemiek van Vleuten have all won in tremendous style, but not in a bunch sprint. Chloe Hosking is of course looking to change that. If Katrin Garfoot can't in fact get a break over Chalamba Crescent, then Loretta Hansen's an excellent sprint opportunity for them. She's an up-and-comer. She's just been getting better every year, faster.
Garfoot's not slow.
Garfoot is not slow. No, but if we're talking about a bunch sprint, then the rider like Loretta Hansen would possibly be a better bet up against Chloe, but you're correct. Garfoot certainly isn't slow.
And then in terms of the final kilometres, we take a look at the race profile and you go towards the back end of the latter part of the 113.4 Ks. This year, the sprint finish has been moved a little bit further along the foreshore to Steam Packet Gardens. So it's more downhill onto the finish line. It's going to be a higher speed sprint finish.
Well, the profile makes it almost look as though they come in on a descent. And it's not quite like that. It's a little bit deceptive on the profile there, but it is definitely, there's no uphill lumps. It's a downhill to flat run, and we do expect it to be quite fast coming in, which suits the sprinters. If they can get over the top of that climb, still in contact, they don't need to be at the front of the bunch. They just need a solid wheel in front of them, which they can then move up from.
And Phil, history tells us the longer the peloton meander along at this sort of pace, the more explosive it will be once the action really does start.
Then we'll find out the strength of the day for sure and how many of the women are surviving here but are not really in the race. And it'll only come, I think, on the climb, 9 kilometres out from the finish. There's got to be a series of attacks by those with ambition. So I think Garfoot will be the one to start it all off. I feel sure about that. And Amanda Spratt's got great form. Rachel Nayland, always sharp and very good tactician. And, of course, Van Vleuten. Well, I think she's still my favourite.
Morzenti, Whitehouse. 20 kilometres to series and the second of the intermediate sprints. A minute and 39 seconds with the peloton yet to really hit the pedals in any sort of anger. If they light it up, it'll only take them a matter of about 5 kilometres to reel in that 1:39. Unfortunately for the two leaders, I've been pessimistic since the start about their chances of surviving to the finish, and I'm equally as pessimistic about their chances of making it to series for the sprint.
Well, they've done a pretty good job of holding the field off. They've certainly stayed out longer than we anticipated. In the last shots we saw of Whitehouse, she was stretching, she was banging her legs. She's starting to look quite fatigued. I'm not sure she expected to still be out there at this point. She's had an up and down day with some misadventure with the flat tyre and not the most efficient wheel change. Could we say, which not only affects her physically, but also emotionally. I have to say I'm very, very impressed at how she rallied after that. It would be easy for that to really affect an athlete, but she's done a pretty good job. Ale Cipollini starting to really bunch toward the front again. We can see Chloe Hosking just on the bottom left-hand side of the screen, just behind, tucked in behind Garfoot and Cromwell, who are now having a bit of a chat.
They're the two riders at the front. It is Cromwell with the dark-coloured helmet on, the yellow helmet with Katrin Garfoot. They've made the right-hand turn off Forest Road. Shortly, they'll make a left-hand turn onto Hendy Main Road. And the wind is very subtle today, if at all, but Hendy Road is a lot more exposed than what Forest Road was. So they're just paying very close attention to the fronts. And it's as if Shannon Molesey, the Australian national champion, was trying to eavesdrop on the conversation in front of her.
Well, you may notice that Katrin Garfoot is wearing the same helmet and riding the same bike as the Mitchelton Scott team. That's because last year she was a member of that team. This year she's not, but she's kept that gear as one of the most important riders in our national team. They're just having a chat. They both look fairly relaxed. Tiffany Cromwell, leader on the road, she's one of the more experienced Australian riders in this international field. And they'll just be discussing tactics and what to do, how long to wait perhaps. Last year, Annemiek van Vleuten did not go into the race as a protected rider for the Mitchelton Scott team, but Amanda Spratt, partway through the race, okay, told van Vleuten that her legs weren't great and they slightly had to change tactics and the way it played out. So while they may go into the race with a firm tactic and a rider to protect, it doesn't always work out like that. So I suggest Tiffany Cromwell's probably also saying to Kat, how are you feeling? Are your legs still good? Are we still on for the anticipated plan?
That ongoing communication. Here's another when their teammates coming forward in the white colours on the left-hand side of the screen. That's Lauren Kitchen, riding for the Quartermanta Real Estate team today, the Australian national team. Throughout season 2018, Kitchen, new team for her. She's riding with the French squad, FDJ. And she'll be joining the other Australian, Shara Gillo, who's been on that team for the last 2 years. Unfortunately, Shara Gillo is not in the race today, but she's had a great couple of seasons with that French outfit. Here are the two leaders once again. I don't believe that they'll survive for too much longer. Robbie McEwen is down in amongst the race. And Robbie, we're 34.2 kilometres to go, but we're going to make the call early. Who do you think is going to win?
Coming up, I'm picking Katrin Garfoot. I've said she's, of course, one of the favourites, but she is my number one pick. And why? Well, I think for one thing, she's in fantastic form. We saw that at the National Championships where she was caught heartbreakingly in the last 50 metres. But for mine, she was the best rider in the race, even though she didn't win the race. But what sets her apart is I think she has that cool, calm, collected manner about her in the race. She's very confident with how she's going, and she's got a really good mix of explosiveness, but that time trial ability as well. So I think she can be the one to really go on the climb and gap everybody, and once she does, she's got the power, she's got the engine to keep that going. If anyone can go with her, I think it's possibly Annemiek van Vleuten. But Katrin Garfoot is not slow in a sprint. And I can tell you, there's a lot of A and B grade club riders on the Gold Coast who she races against when she's home that can testify to the fact that she's pretty fast at the finish because she's cleaned up a lot of those blokes in the club races. So she gets a lot of training for a sprint finish as well. So she's my pick all round. She's also got a point to prove. She's no longer with Mitchelton Scott because she wanted to stay at home in Australia, not travel anymore, not be away overseas, and at least see her husband a little bit. She's been away on the road for the last couple of years. But she's got a point to prove it. I can do it this way, riding in the national team, staying at home, and it's a big preparation towards Commonwealth Games, and she'd love to get the first big win of the season in the one-day races.
There you heard it from Robbie McEwen, triple winner of the green jersey at the Tour de France. He's on board. Katrin Garfoot, who's from the Gold Coast, just like Robbie. And Katrin Garfoot, she has had a really good start to the season. She won the individual time trial title for the third year running at the National Championships. And it was a victory of more than 2.5 minutes on her nearest rival, Lucy Kennedy, with Shara Gillow in third position. Garfoot will be heavily marked. We're waiting to see a bit of action from her Quartermentha real estate team to make the race a little bit tougher. Here are our two leaders once again. Whitehead out in front for Sydney Uni Staminade, and it's Morzenti, number 75, the Italian from the B Pink team.
Well, they've continued to keep the pressure on. They've got on with their job. They've not worried what the peloton are doing at the moment. Peloton quite clearly is wait and see. That's been their attitude for a long while now. Some 60 kilometres ahead now for White House, and she was joined by Morzenti. And 32 kilometres goes, 20 miles still left to race, but it's the hardest part of the course ahead, and the peloton knows that, and that's why they're waiting. They're in fighting. They really don't include these two in the competition as far as they are concerned. 134 will never survive the day.
Well, they've got 17 kilometres till the next intermediate sprint, I think. One step at a time. If they can survive till there, then Georgia Whitehouse could potentially get a very big reward, or Morzenti. Whoever takes that sprint out could get the Mapei sprint jersey for the day for their efforts. You kind of hope that they survive, even by a few seconds, for that to be rewarded for this quite epic effort.
They deserve to survive as they make their way past the Agapanthas and into Mauriac for the feed zone. These two won't really need to take advantage of the feed zone. As being in the breakaway, they've had the chance to regularly go back to their team car, pick up water bottles, pick up any food that required. And finally, Whitehouse, she's had the last tube that was on the top tube.
Well, she can pick a few more up in the feed zone if she needs some more of those. It is important, of course, to hydrate and to eat while you're out on course. You can get a very terrible negative energy effect at the back end of the race if you don't take care of that. The peloton does look like they're stretching out a bit, heading into the feed zone, simply in order to be able to grab their bottles. If they're all grouped together, it's very difficult to be able to get that. But honestly, they just look quite disinterested in racing. It's within, 32 kilometres to go. At what point they need to really turn the screws and get into it? Because of the hard nature of that final 10 kilometres, they really can leave it quite late.
What do you think after the feed zone? Do we see some action once they get out the other side of Mauriac?
Oh, to be honest, I think they'll leave it almost to the last minute. We might see a few mild attacks, but they have not indicated at any point yet, Matt, that they're interested in animating it early and forcing the pace. We've seen the teams start to group toward the front, which is an indicator, but we can see they're in the middle of the peloton. Four of the Mitchelton Scott riders, that's Amanda Spratt, number two just at the back there, number three Janelle Crooks at the front. Annemiek van Vleuten is the sole Mitchelton rider heading up toward the front, but there's certainly no concerted team effort to lift the pace at all.
No, but it may be significant that van Vleuten has come right up to the front there and taken the inside. and she's in a position now to do something about it. Now, that will not have gone unnoticed because they're running out of time, let's face it, 31 kilometres out, and it's still 15 kilometres before the second sprint, so they're not sure they're going to stay away, those two women up front. If they did, well, obviously, they've taken most of the points, and the finish would not make any difference to the final standings, but we'll see. What I can't understand is why so many riders are lying off the back wheels of each other here, unless they've been back to the cars, because there's been no pressure to cause this situation.
The only thing I can think, Phil, is that heading into the feed zone, the teams will want to separate themselves from each other in order to get water bottles. Each team will have one or two soigneurs standing on the side of the road with a water bottle, and if each rider is stacked one behind the other, it's very difficult for all six riders to, in fact, get the bottles. So we see on the left the WOW deals have three or four riders in a row. They kind of need to mix that up and break that up a bit if they want access to the food and water that the soigneurs will have ready for them. But certainly playing out in an interesting way. The whole team is together there, in fact, the WOW deals cycling team. Down the left-hand side, you can see the green aqua jerseys. Mitchelton Scott on the right, relatively together as well. Some specialised women's racing taking the advantage of the slowing pace to move out and improve their position.
126 hovered. They've got them absolutely pegged. Front and back doing the same speed here. 30.6 kilometres to go. We've got through the undulations. We're getting onto slightly more, less hostile roads for a little while. The wind itself is non-existent, unheard of in this part of the world. It is an idyllic day in Geelong, absolutely beautiful, just very, very pleasant conditions, and a lovely crowd waiting to bring these riders back home.
But when you say hostile, it makes it sound like a war zone. The riders certainly have had a reasonably pleasant day out on course, save for those two breakaway riders who have been slugging it out for quite a while now. They went on a reasonably early breakaway. We didn't think they'd survive this long. Against the odds, I think we could say. They've maintained over that minute.
They didn't know each other this morning. They know each other now.
And they shan't forget each other after a day together like this. The New Zealand national team, they're a young team, all under 23 riders. Interestingly, they're the ones forcing a little bit of pace here, not in an attacking style, just lifting the pace of the peloton and taking some responsibility for that. They've got some great, talented young riders. Grace Anderson was in exceptional form in Adelaide at the Tour Down Under. We haven't seen much of her today. She's back in the peloton. The Shalumbra Crescent climb will suit her to a T.
That's why you haven't seen much of her. She's waiting. And the New Zealand team here, getting big experience because they don't get the chance to race against the top women of the world in this part of the world. So big experience for the youngsters there from New Zealand. And now you can see the gap. 1:08 now. They know exactly what they're doing in the peloton. Inside 30 kilometres, they've got this race totally under control.
There's Robbie McEwen. He's just bridged across to the breakaway the easy way on the back of the motorbike.
He's having the easiest day of anybody out there, jetting between the breakaway and the main peloton. The pace has increased. The New Zealand team taking a bit of responsibility and forcing the other riders. You can start to see that they're working a little bit harder. It's going slightly uphill here. We can see the shoulders bopping a little bit about. That's a good indicator of effort going on there.
Kate, we've heard from Robbie McEwen. He's declared his hand. He's tipped number 131, Katrin Garfoot, as the winner today. Who are you on?
Well, I'm going to go with a similar number theme, and I'm going to go for number 31, Chloe Hosking. There she is. She's just sitting pretty, kind of cool as a cucumber in the middle of the pack there, not working too hard, very protected. For a sprinter as herself, she won the final stage of the Santos Tour Down Under, and after a fall as well in the middle of that race. She's just sitting there looking after herself, fresh legs, fresh mind.
Do you think the calmness of the race is to her advantage or disadvantage? Because this calmness will make it more explosive on the climb.
Well, I think it works to her advantage because she is actually quite a handy climber in a one-off scenario. What gets Chloe is the cumulative effect of some long climbs. So I think it plays into her hand. She's also really feisty. So every minute that they just tick over like this, she's kind of rubbing her hands together and thinking, oh, thank you, ladies, playing right into my hands.
The great thing about Chloe Hosking is you're never in any doubt where you stand.
No, you're right about that. She's got that real sprinter mentality. She's kind of like Robbie McEwen, you know, of the women's peloton. You just always know that she will fight to the absolute death. If she can sniff it,
yes,
she can definitely get over climbs that if she didn't imagine the finish was there, that she wouldn't be able to. The breakaway, they're almost back. They're within 25 seconds now, but more importantly, the peloton's just there. They're right behind.
They're about to be caught.
25 metres is probably better right now. Yeah, they're coming back in now. It's all over. 29 kilometres out, and they started this move 91 kilometres out. So it's time for...
That proved to be the case.
But they've actually proved us wrong in getting this far. So full kudos to them. Yep. And as we say, once across the country, she's from Canberra on her mountain bike, getting form, a little bit of a different way to spend the off-season. But certainly for Gracie, it helps her keep her head screwed on. It keeps her relaxed. And not a lot of pressure.
Keeps her fresh. Number 51, down to the left, Shannon Molsey, Australian national champion. She's looking very composed. The team's got confidence in her, which is important.
Linda Willemsen from Team Virtue Cycling.
She's never got her off.
She's got great credentials. You certainly don't want to let her go on her own. She hasn't attacked yet. Normally, regardless of anything, when the speed drops, Linda isn't afraid to give it a bit of stick and dig her heels in and have a go. So I'd suggest she's also waiting for the back end of the race.
Just looking at 132, just coming to camera here, Kate. That's Rachel Nayland taking to the cross-country bit, and she's OK. But we've never talked to her in any year as a possible winner of this race. She won the first one, then she finished third, then she finished second. She's always finished in the top three of this race.
The challenge for Rachel Nayland today is the fact that she's got the big pre-race favourite on her team, Katrin Garfoot, and a secondary favourite as well with Lauren Kitchen. She's also spoken about the fact that she's targeting some races later in the season, and she's been in the gym, doing a lot of work in the gym, and she's found it a little difficult with the soreness in the legs from the gym work and translating that to the bike, and her form's not quite, in her mind, where she thinks it needs to be at this point. Number 125, Whitehouse at the back with teammates wrapping their arms around her. Likewise, number 75, Morzenti. The two women are in the breakaway all day long.
Done a great ride. The names that we'll talk about, I hope, for the rest of the season now. We've seen them in action here. These long straight roads are very depressing if you're in the lead, but there's nobody in the lead now. And take a look at the sharp end of the peloton. The ones who feel they have a chance are now in the front 25 riders of the race.
Here comes a right-hand turn. Although it's not windy, it is a lot more exposed again at this point. And you can feel the tempo is starting to increase. This is Janelle Crooks, who is now at the front. And just behind her is Rhianna Marcus from the Well Deals team. And there's a little bit of movement. It is the Holden Gusto team trying to slip off the front.
Nice move.
Matilda Reynolds has put in a lot of effort for the Holden team, Gusto. She's a very aggressive rider, and she's instigated this move. She's not getting a lot of help. The two riders following her from Team 2020 and Tibco, they're happy to just sit there and let Matilda do the work. But Mitchelton Scott are getting organised. On the left, that's Amanda Spratt. On the front, Sarah Roy.
Oh, no,
following just behind. Van Vloten coming through. There must be some crosswinds. The way they are riding like this indicates to me that there's some serious crosswinds going on.
And this is Gracie Alvin now coming through to the front.
Orders are out. This is the move, 23K out.
It's turned into a team time trial for Mitchelton Scott. What wind there is slightly from the left shoulder. Sarah Roy now charging through. Getting down towards the business end of the race, and it is really starting to heat up.
Yeah, that change of direction, the wind has increased by about 5 kilometres an hour as we come away from the coast, and that has been noticed. Now, you see the split at the back now, the weaker riders unhitching a little bit. Caught, wasn't expecting that, that's a bad move.
Annemiek van Vleuten, the number one. Most pre-race interviews with her go something along the lines of, we want to make it hard at the start, we'll attack in the middle and go full gas at the finish. This is Amanda Spratt. Next is Sarah Roy coming through. The white colours with the Kiwi national champion. We can see the damage at the back of the peloton.
Yeah, our two breakaway heroes will be looking to survive the pressure just now. They're 23 kilometres out from the finishing line. Take a look over the shoulder of the peloton. It's catching a few women out now.
Chloe Hosking just tucked into the Mitchelton train there, looking after herself. You need to stay out of the wind and fairly protected. She's a very smart rider. This is a very savvy move. This gives me confidence in my pick, I've got to say, to see her riding in such a protective way. She's not relying on her teammates. She knows they're there if she needs them, but she's really taking it into her own hands. Shannon Mulseed, the national champion, sitting tightly just in next to her. When you see the might of the Mitchelton Scott team go to the front, you'd be a bit of a fool to ignore it. Pleased to see the pre-race favourites are paying attention at this point, because this is a really decisive time in the race. 22 kilometres left to go. Not a flat section, really.
You talk about the strength in numbers of the team with Mitchelton Scott. Chloe Hosking, virtually on her own at the front for the LA Cipollini team. If there's anybody in this race that can get the job done without teammates, it is Chloe Hosking. But having said that, the fluoro colours of LA Cipollini, a few of them have arrived because they know they've got a contender. Chloe is in the mix.
It gives you a lot of confidence to know that you have your team there, but also know how to look after yourself and protect yourself just in case they don't turn up at the right moment. When she won the stage last week in Adelaide, the entire team fell off with a couple of laps to go. And at the finish, Chloe was on her own in terms of a lead out. But what we saw when she crossed the lines with her arm in the air was her teammates, 50, 60 back, also put their arms in the air. It was a very big team effort, and she's in very good hands. Just having them there is a big confidence booster. Matilda Reynolds again at the front of the bunch for the Holden team. And Virtue Cycling, that's Trina Smith. She's a very good track rider. I'm not sure she'll get over the Chalamba Crescent climb, but she's been European champion and certainly has a turn of speed.
Here's the next move. It's the Trek Drops team which are attacking now as they're heading towards the outskirts of Geelong, the exposed roads. And Katrin Garfoot is the rider in the white colours from Cordamenta Real Estate who is doing the responding.
Well, forget the legs for a moment here. If you're not paying attention, that's where the biggest damage get done.
It was Georgie Williams who's got the white colours on with the yellow helmet. The New Zealand national champion it was that closed it down. Yeah. Garfoot is just a few wheels further back, riding protected from the wind. Very smart.
The teams that matter have come to the front, as they often do. 21K out, they're looking at the first sprint. Nobody's really interested in that sprint. It's more a stepping stone to the climb itself, because the sprint is 15 kilometres out and we go over the top of the crescent at 9 kilometres from the finish. And by then, I suspect our peloton will be half the size it is now, because they've told the helpers on the team, what we call the domestiques, to drive the pace, and it's had an effect.
And every time an attempt to cause a split gets nullified, you just see heads on a swivel, looking around, waiting for the next move.
Well, and if they're not careful, they look one way and the attack goes the other way. What's really smart in this kind of scenario is to hug one side of the road, and then attacks can only come from one side. If you're just sitting in the middle, you're kind of open left and right.
If they were mothers, they wouldn't have a problem, because all mums have got eyes in the back of their heads as well. Never miss a beat. At least my mum never did. Back of the peloton. Survival time for some. The young New Zealand national team at the back of the group. That was Grace Anderson, number 142. Rode brilliantly across in Adelaide, winning the best young rider classification in the Santos Tour Down Under.
You can see a lot of movement in the peloton here. They are all together and bunched up, but there's a lot of side-to-side athletes choosing their position within the field, using it as a bit of recovery fill, but also maybe to get a cheeky few moves up of position without having to spend too much energy.
Well, Robbie McEwen is right in the thick of the action at the front of the peloton. Robbie, the race is really starting to change complexion.
Well, Matt, yes, it is, because now we are hitting the hilly part of the circuit onto that first major climb that brings them back into Geelong. They've just dived down that downhill at 80 kilometres an hour, and we're now getting an attack from Janelle Crooks. So Mitchelton Scott are starting to play their cards. We said they had strength in numbers, and they're using now as soon as the road goes up. Crooks straight out of the saddle, and she is riding as if she's in the last 300 metres of a stage, being chased by one of the LA Cipollini riders. Things really starting to string out at the front. But Crooks sits down, has a look, goes another gear. She's giving it everything she's got, and this is not with her own chances in mind. That's one thing for certain. They just want to make the race hard and use their numerical superiority. So she sits down, she's lifting herself out of the saddle again, always trying to re-accelerate. Looking down the line, I see Chloe Hosking still hanging tough in that first 10. Katrin Garfoot, she's down almost in a time trial position, staying out of the wind. So at the moment, Mitchelton Scott starting to stir things up, and we've got another uphill coming in just a moment. But first, another fast dive down. It's going to be jostling for positions to try and make that attack, because the longer climb is yet to come.
Janelle Crooks, the sacrificial lamb.
I'm not sure that that's the title she gets given in the race meeting, but that's certainly what happens. A great attack from her, a great chase from Ale Cipollini, from Soraya Paladin. Of course, we don't expect Ale Cipollini to join any leaders and chase. What they're doing is protecting Chloe. We could see that Chloe Hosking was just a few wheels back looking after herself. What we can also see, the edge of the road, it's a little bit rough. They've got a ripple strip to contend with. The riders need to be really careful to choose their point in the road, save as much energy as they can. It was this point on the course a couple of years ago that Amanda Spratt really took an advantage and forced the pace. The peloton was reduced to 20 or 30 in those efforts. We're not quite down to that yet, but we can see that the peloton are starting to suffer. Some riders have fallen off the back. We can expect another attack. Mitchelton Scott are primed to do it, but everybody is on high alert.
Still a large portion of the original peloton, 87 starters in contact. The next to move, and again, it is Janelle Crooks, so she really is the sacrificial lamb. Break the race up, Janelle, the youngest rider on the team, and she is doing some damage.
This is to be expected. They know they're the team to beat. They know everybody expects them to provide the race with its winner. And so they're waiting for their moves, but they're marking the moves at the moment. And there's a reaction coming again from the field, or is there?
This is the Wiggle team. This is Barbieri that is marking the move. Another one of the young riders in the race.
I have a feeling the whole of the Mitchelton Scott team just blocked off the peloton, but it's clawing its way back anyway.
Well, Janelle Crooks is starting to look a bit fatigued as the sacrificial lamb, as you put it, Matt. She is just going to keep attacking until she can't attack anymore. But people are heightened to that. It was Lauren Kitchen from the Cordamantha Real Estate team who bridged across there, bringing the field with them. Amanda Spratt, look, she's just sitting back. She's quite relaxed.
And in fourth position, it's one of the riders from the Silence Pro Cycling team. That's the team of Georgia Bronzini, the world champion from Geelong in 2010. We haven't mentioned her much recently. Haven't seen her either, mind you. But if she stays in there and hides and sneaks through and gets over the climbs, she's another really quick sprinter.
Well, that's a mark of a very smart bike race from them, that we have not mentioned them because we have not seen them.
Next move is coming, and this time it is Amanda Spratt who goes.
Now, this will be a real serious shape, and there's a quick reaction here. Not surprisingly, shut down immediately.
And Garfoot is
winner.
Who does
the She's
job.
The first one to do it as she jumps onto the back wheel of Spratt, because Spratt is very much a marked woman.
Sarah
Top
Roy,
two finish.
Just a few wheels back, and she goes. Sarah Roy for Mitchelton Scott applies the pressure.
Roy is going. Loretta Hansen is the one with the blue helmet who is trying to respond. Sarah Roy, more noted as a sprinter, but not the sort of rider you can give too much latitude to.
I think we have a few sacrificial lambs in the Mitchelton.
There's no doubt the whole
today.
Team is racing for Van Vleuten right now, and that's why they're throwing everybody else into these moves. And Anne Meek will be watching the move, and there's just one or two of the riders back there.
Just 1 kilometre until the sprint now, Phil. They won't be really looking too much to go for the sprint. Chloe Hosking in third wheel, taking care of herself, just making sure she's safe. The danger zone is when those attacks come back, and the next one is sure to go.
Well, she better watch out, because this is a move by Katrin Hammers of Germany here for Trek. And there's an attack by Spratt.
Van Vleuten it is.
Sorry, Van Vleuten,
number
yes.
One, and the reaction coming from 1-3-1. The two pre-race favourites, former teammates, Van Vleuten, then Garfoot, followed by Spratt and Chloe Hosking. Four of the big favourites at the front.
Not too sure why they did that. Because the attacks have been coming thick and fast, but it's the three favourites, one 131 and 2 have gone out together with Hoskins on the back wheel of them.
And the rider in the purplish colours from Trek Drops, that's Taylor Wiles. Spratt, is she going again? Yes, she is. Hosking is right on her hammer, followed then by Shannon Molseed.
Well, we're going to see a nice sprint for 1, 2 and 3 in this. 3, 2, 1 points in the Mapei sprint.
I think they're ignoring the sprint and trying to win the bike race.
Maybe, but don't forget, the winner of this sprint is going to score heavily at the finish. They could do the double.
Interesting tactics by Mitchelton Scott. They really are very clearly after the win here today. They're sending one rider after another. Janelle Crooks, Sarah Roy. We've seen Amanda Spratt and Van Vloten.
And that graphic tells the story, the amount of climbing that they've done in the last 2 kilometres.
Well, they've got a bit of a descent coming up before they head up that nasty one into Shalambra Crescent. A breakaway of three is heading off the front.
That's the first three for the sprint.
And that's Georgia Williams, another Mitchelton Scott rider. Lauren Kitchen fast on her wheel, and Alison Jackson from Team Tibco Silicon Valley Bank. The three riders do look to have a small gap. We'll wait till we can pan back to the peloton to see how far they're gone. I'd be surprised if they're letting them get too far away, but Georgia Williams, we know she's on form.
Lauren
She's
Kitchen
certainly forcing the pace.
Here's the rider who sits in second position. Jackson at the rear of the group. Another rider coming across. This time it's from the Wiggle High Five team, and it's the French woman, Audrey Cordon.
Don't write this lady off. She's a terrific bike rider. Four in the lead now. Four teams represented.
Four strong teams represented.
It's a very dangerous move because they are Mitchelton Scott and the Quartermantha Real Estate National Team are represented there. They are arguably two of the strongest teams. If they're represented in the break, there's nobody left to chase. They're not letting them get too far. The other teams need to really pay attention now. Chloe Hosking will be just holding a good wheel and hoping that somebody else chases. She does have 4, 5 good, strong teammates to pull it back if needed.
And no sprint.
Well, Jackson wants the points. Jackson, she opens up. She's looking for the 3 points, and she collects them in the race for the Mapei sprint classification. So that puts her into equal first position with Whitehouse, who was in the breakaway and won the sprint into Torquay.
And it's Sarah Roy that comes through second. Lauren Kitchen in third. After an intermediate sprint, it's a very, very dangerous time because riders often take that opportunity to make the attack and make the move. Sarah Roy has chosen to force the pace, but with the peloton right on the tail, she's sat up. A little bit of cat and mouse beginning to be played, Phil. Lauren Kitchen patrolling the front, looking to a left, looking to a right. Shannon Molseed.
She better look to her right now because that's the champion of Australia joining the front. And she's just gone to the back wheel there of Hammers of Germany.
Spratt has attacked again at the front. And also Rachel Nalan in second position, the winner of the inaugural edition of the Deakin University Cadel Evans Great Ocean Road Race.
These are the leg breakers now because they are only a few kilometres from the start of the climb. And the strong ones will keep the pressure on.
Still a very big peloton. Van Vloten, number one, trying to move up the right-hand side in the gutter, but it's a relatively safe gutter. It's a very new one. Oh, a little bit of a dab, almost losing the handlebars, hitting one of the cat's eyes on the road there for the Kiwi. There's Cardinia Park off in the distance. Corio Bay, the destination, the finish line in Geelong.
It's a bit of a section of recovery as they scoop down in toward town. The peloton is very reduced. We haven't necessarily seen the riders dropping off the back, but from that aerial shot and that front shot, we can see that it is reduced. The Mapei sprint, we didn't know if it would be contested.
And it was Jackson who got the 3 points. Sarah Roy collecting 2 points, and then Audrey Cordon collecting the 1 point. Now the top three place getters for the second of the intermediate sprints.
The Quartermantha Real Estate National Australian National Team are all grouping just to the right of picture there, starting to come to the front. Tiffany Cromwell, that's Peter Mullins that is on the front there. Tiffany Cromwell is road captain, is instructing. I've seen her, you know, pat the girls on the back a bit, push them up. She's in second wheel there. Loretta Hansen sitting in third with Lauren Kitchen in fourth. The we've got Katrin Garfoot, of course, as one of the race favourites that they are looking after. Katrin Garfoot, we can just see her on the left of screen in the yellow helmet, similar to the Mitchelton Scott team. She was, of course, formerly of that team.
This is a cavalry charge to the start of the climb now, and Garfoot is being brought there to spring away from behind her teammates. And that's going to increase her favourite ranking right now. She's in a perfect position here.
In previous editions of the race, at this point, they would have been making the left-hand turn to take the shortcut over the climb, the backside of Chilamba Crescent. This time around, they're heading further into Geelong before they eventually make a left-hand turn to go up the climb that we saw as part of the World Championships in 2010. And it is brutally steep at the top.
It's going to prove decisive, I think. We'll get the strong women away at least. I don't think the sprinters will survive this one. But they still have a chance, if they don't lose too much ground, to get back before the finish. At the moment, the pace being set by Loretta Hansen.
And it's the Cordamenta Real Estate team with four riders at the
Peter
front.
Mullins now,
they've got Mullins. Hansen is there, so too Cromwell. And in fourth position is Garfoot. Behind her is Chloe Hosking. And now we're seeing Lauren Kitchen move around the outside. Gracie Alvin, number four. They know the battle that is about to commence on the climb. And it's the Cordamenta Real Estate team who are taking full responsibility for the race.
Well, it's theirs to lose. We knew Chloe Hosking. We know that this will be a challenging course for her, but her positioning, it indicates that she's confident. It indicates that she's got good legs. She's got prime position up there. Her teammates, they're coming and going depending on how the course is turning up and down. At the moment, they're sweeping down back into town. Not so much a section of recovery, though, because the Cordamenta Real Estate National Team are doing an exceptionally good job of keeping the peloton strung out. They're in a lot of control. Mitchelton Scott, we don't have a lot of the riders together. Annemiek van Vleuten in the middle of the field there. She needs to start moving up. She needs to grab a teammate. She's got Georgia Williams there in the national champions' colours of New Zealand. Amanda Spratt moving up on the right-hand side.
Well, look, they're almost on the climb. Once it starts, it'll be an explosion.
That was number two, Amanda Spratt, moving around the outside. In the green colours with number 12 was Anouska Costa, who's a former Dutch national champion. This is the left-hand turn. They're getting very close towards the climb now, Phil.
And as they line up for this climb now, expect Katrin Garfoot to try and go from the lower slopes to get a gap that she can hold for the next 9 kilometres to the finish. But I think you're right, Chloe Hosking believes in herself today. She was fourth in this race last year, but of course, it didn't come quite the same way in to the finish. Job done for Tiff Cromwell.
Swings off, gets out of the way. She's given the instructions. She's done the job. It's up to the rest of them to finish it off.
We just saw Shannon Molseed back toward the end of the peloton. That's not a good place for her to be. She really, really needs to move up. She's got the legs to do it. Loretta Hansen doing a very big job for Katrin Garfoot. Lauren Kitchen sitting on a wheel. Chloe Hosking tucked in. And that's Gracie Elvin just behind Hosking.
They are lining up for the base of the climb. This is Loretta Hansen who's setting the tempo. She's a good sprinter. She knows the climb is not for her. She's spending everything to get to the bottom, to make it hard, to soften the legs for the rivals of Katrin Garfoot, because Garfoot on this climb will go.
If anybody ever had any doubt that this was a team sport, Phil, this is the perfect example of how a team can win or lose you a race.
Well, the team has given Katrin Garfoot a perfect lead to the mountain. Now, can she crack it?
Robbie, you're down in amongst it. Katrin Garfoot, how does she look?
She looks incredible at the moment. Now she's just on the front. That was like watching a sprint lead out coming onto the bottom of the climb. But Garfoot is now on the front, Kitchen just behind her. But last night, I was speaking to the team director from the Cordamenta team. They said, Katrin Garfoot will go all the way up the climb. She's about to take the turn onto the steepest part. She's looking incredibly comfortable, and I see pain on a lot of faces in what is left of the peloton. It is splitting to pieces after about 15th wheel. Garfoot on the front, out of the saddle, and riders are starting to pull out left and right and be dropped, and it's starting to really whittle down. Chloe Hosking still there in fourth wheel, fifth wheel, starting to be in difficulty. Van Vleuten coming to the front now, and it's an attack from one of the riders from Wow Deals. And to me, that looks like it's Sabrina Stultjens.
It is.
The Dutch girl. The Dutch girl, it is too. And what a powerful attack. Her teammates have been saying all morning, she's our woman. She's the one who's going to tear this thing apart. And she looks incredible.
She's been waiting patiently. They're getting towards the steep part of the climb, and now she is going.
Well, we're watching and then trying to get on turns. Molly Weaver of Great Britain here. Alison Jackson is the Canadian rather than the Silicon Bank TIBCO team. And she's coming up.
Jackson, who is fighting. Garfoot, not what you would say in the distance, but she is fighting to hold on. This is a brilliant performance by the Dutch woman at the front.
Well, she won one of the QOMs over at the Tour Down Under. We know that she can climb. She fell ill after that and couldn't complete the race. She was very disappointed, but we know that she can climb. This isn't unexpected. But what we need to see from Garfoot, from Hosking, from any of the Mitchelton Scott riders, they just need to be within sniffing distance. When they go over the top of the climb, they've still got 9 kilometres left to race. If they can still just ahead that break, I believe it can come back together. Katrin Garfoot bridging across now.
Number one.
Annemiek van Vleuten suffering a little bit behind Katrin Garfoot, but still in contention. Look how comfortable Stolchens looks. She's really climbing above and beyond. This is a bit of a surprise perhaps for Katrin, but she looks very composed. Van Vleuten in a bit of trouble.
Garfoot is now coming. She's making the most of the rapid tempo that has been set on this climb. But Stolten's, she does look composed. The Dutch woman in green is yet to win a professional race. She's had a second. She was eighth in the Route de France, and she is in a good position at the moment, trying to stick with Garfoot, who is opening up the throttle.
Garfoot has got to get some sort of a lead now. She's a great time trialist. She's the world champion if she can just hold it to the line. But these other three are fighters. Jackson's the surprise. She's looked absolutely shattered on the far right. And Van Vleuten has slipped on the far left here. She knows over the top of this climb, still in contention with Garfoot, she will win the day. That is the top. Garfoot goes over the top first.
So she gets the points in the race for the Subaru Queen of the Mountains, but Garfoot Kate, she looks so strong.
Incredibly impressive climb up there. She started a little bit back, but she clawed her way and then accelerated straight past.
It's not enough, Kate.
It's not enough. These three will come back together, whether it's three, whether it's more. It'll come back together. It's still playing well into Garfoot's hands. What she does know now, Phil, is that she's stronger than Van Vleuten. She's in better shape and better condition. And Van Vleuten is going to have to work very hard in the threesome. If they're going to come together to the line, there'll be a strong chase behind. 9 kilometres, it can be a long way back.
She was stronger than Van Vleuten on the climb. It's a different matter now. She's over the climb. And I think you'll find Annemiek will be stronger than Katrien. And what about Stolchens, the Dutch woman? She's really climbed so well, and I've never heard of her.
Well, there's one more climb to come. Here she is. She's 24 years of age. In November, she was across in Western Australia, spent some time at the Tour of Margaret River. That was a key part of her preparation for the season. And she is part of this team at the request of Marianne Vos, the great Dutch woman who was one of the all-time greats of cycling, riding the conversation with the likes of Eddie Merckx and Bernard Hinault. She chose Stolten's to be on this team.
Well, that was a very good choice by Marianne, without doubt is one of the greatest Dutch cyclists who have ever turned a pedal. These three now, three big names, it seems, but Van Vleuten is in prime position in the middle. Stolchens done what she wants to do. At least Van Vleuten and Stolchens can talk together, but they're on rival teams, don't forget.
New team this year for number 14. Last year, she was with the Sunweb squad. This time around, it's with Wael Deels in the green colours. Quickly down here, across a very narrow bridge, and then one more steep climb.
And Garfoot's got to go there. She's got to go on the climb.
Well, none of them are noted sprinters.
No.
But none of them are particularly slow either. Van Vleuten, she knows the strength of Garfoot. Number one is not working. She is waiting for this climb in the hope she can survive.
Or jump away.
And we know how tough she is. She's ditched the last bit, 7.4 kilometres to go. No more water required. And she's wary of her compatriot.
She knows, obviously, she should do. But this is not a fast push, and we can't see behind just now. There might well be a reaction from the field soon. No Mitchelton Scott to chase, of course. And no Cordamental Australian team to chase. There's the single lane bridge down there, which was altered for the route of the championships back in 2010.
And there goes Van Vleuten, going over the top as they hit the base of the climb. A few hundred metres up this climb, they make a left-hand turn, and that's where it gets really steep. And this is an opportunity for Garfoot. Quickly into the small chain ring for Garfoot. She knows the course. Van Vleuten has done the same. And now so too does Sabrina Stultens. Here comes the left-hand turn. Katrin Garfoot, one of the big pre-race favourites. So too, number one last year's winner, Annemiek van Vleuten. But Sabrina Stultens could be the one to cause the big surprise.
Last time I saw Sabrina Stultens.
Robbie, you're down with the 3 litres. Your final thoughts?
Well, I'm having a look at all three, and Garfoot, she's doing all the work. Van Vleuten looks to be labouring a little bit, head up, head down, rocking and rolling on over the bike. They're coming out onto the steepest section of this little uphill. It is about 16%, and Garfoot is making another acceleration, and the gap's just starting to maybe open. Van Vleuten, she's literally turning herself inside out to stay on the wheel. It's Garfoot putting on all the pressure, and Stultens, she looks very comfortable with it, and even though she looks uncomfortable, Van Vleuten, she's made it over this hardest part of the climb. From here, it's flat and downhill all the way to the finish. It'll be more of a tactical battle, and then who has the fastest legs in the sprint?
Phil, do they come any tougher than number one Annemiek van Vleuten?
And she's probably reminding herself right now, I'm the number one, they can't drop me, and she's hanging in, because if she comes over these hills still in touch, believe me, she'll go for them. I actually remember commentating on Stultens back in 2015 now, Matt, I've just remembered. She was second in a race in Johannesburg in South Africa when she was 21 years of age. It's known as the 94.7. It's now called the 947.
Here's the remnants of the peloton. There's the LA Cipollini colours. Chloe Hosking riding towards the front. Rachel Nayland is there as well. She's a teammate of Katrin Garfoot, who was off the front. Amanda Spratt, number two, is also in that very select group. That looks like Shannon Molseed, the Australian national champion, at the rear of the group. Here are the leaders, and they're leaving all the work up to number 131, Katrin Garfoot.
They've no choice. I don't think they can help her just now, and she feels this might be the winning move, but, you know, there are 15 women in that chase group.
Stultens.
Yep, Stultens is gone. She sensed they're slowing down, and that's a terrific acceleration.
Trying to make the most of the little game of cat and mouse between these two former teammates.
Well, that's the way to do it. Two favourites won't help each other.
This could be the winning move.
It could be the winning move. 6 kilometres out from home.
And look at the gap that has quickly opened up. Garfoot looks into the eyes of Van Vleuten. She's now on to race radio, speaking with the team car, seeking instructions. And Van Vleuten is not moving.
And Stultens has never, ever won a professional race. And if they don't react very quickly, she's going to win this one.
She's had 2 second-place finishes throughout her career so far. She's 5.5 kilometres away from her first win. And what would it mean to her in her first big international race with her new team up against the great Dutch woman, Annemiek van Vleuten, the world's number one? There she is, number 14 from the Well Deals team. Last year she rode with the Sunweb squad, just one season with that team.
You know, as we said right at the top of the commentary, this team is trained and looked after by Jerome Blylevens, a 4-time stage winner in the Tour de France and a great sprinter. And he's put all his knowledge into this squad by the look of it now. Sabrina Stultens out on the attack on her own. Who is going to chase her? Who can chase her? There's two of the favourites behind her. They won't attack each other. They won't work with each other, rather. And there are 15 in the peloton back of those two.
8 seconds is her advantage to the two chasers. 30 seconds to the peloton.
Wow. Deals.
Indeed. And what is it about 8 seconds and close bike races?
Yes, 1989, Tour de France. Greg LeMond and Laurent Fignon.
It looks like the two chasers are now starting to work together. Garfoot and Van Vleuten have recognised if they don't collaborate, they're racing for second.
I think they are racing for second right now. I think the peloton will come back up to them. Although the chief referee's car is still in there with Wayne Pomeroy in there.
That's the first look over the shoulder that we've seen from Sabrina Stultens since she's gone off the front. Normally the look across the shoulder is a little bit of concern at sore legs. On that occasion, I don't believe it was. That was a quick assessment.
The 24-year-old has her birthday during the Tour de France in the month of July. She's made the move. She's got to complete it now. She's totally committed. She's inside 4 kilometres to go. The road continually switches direction. That's good for the breakaway. These two are not working. Van Vleuten's had to go to the front now.
I think they are now. Van Vleuten has recognised if she doesn't contribute with Garfoot, the race is all over. So number one, Van Vleuten. Number 1-3-1, that is Garfoot. Two big pre-race favourites, and Stultens was barely mentioned. She's the one to catch.
Well, that's because we've never heard of her, really, as a top performer, but she's so young. Now we've all heard of her. The big teams will be looking to sign her up, possibly, as the season unwinds. Very, very strong woman. Showed us she can climb on steep climbs as well.
The long straight road, that gives her nowhere to hide. Almost inside the last 3 kilometres.
Going to be a long 3K, Matt.
But most of it is ever so slightly downhill, which is to her advantage.
Well, she's been up amongst it in some of the biggest races in the world, like 11th in the Tour of Italy, at a stage race, of course. One-day races are so much different. It's consistency in the multi-day races, it's strength and ambition and success in the one-day races.
And when she was 11th in that Tour of Italy, it was number one who's chasing her, Annemiek van Vleuten, who was the winner. So the young Dutch woman clearly not intimidated by the world number one. In fact, she's attacked her. The pan back. Well, that's a big gap.
That's enough. There's the 15 chase. Oh, swelled a little bit since, so they've slowed down, or people have got back on over the hill. A much bigger bunch now, maybe 20 riders down there. Where's the two chasers? There they are. That's the lead. I think they've picked up the two chasers.
In fact, the chasers have been caught by the peloton, and now it's Stultens, who's the only sole survivor, with 2.5 kilometres remaining. The last time check we had was 30 seconds. It looks much closer than that now, but it is still doable. This is a brave move.
Well, she cannot afford to look round anymore now. She either wins or she finishes last. It's as simple as that. And this is, I remember Cadel Evans coming down here in the World Championship road race back in 2010. He was the defending world champion on that occasion. She goes over this bridge, which must seem like a mountain now. Over the railway tracks, they can see her, but can they organise themselves to bring her back?
12 seconds is her advantage. In fact, it looks like it's a lot less than that. This could turn out to be a bunch sprint finish of 20 or so riders. Grace Brown is still in that chasing
group. 6 seconds. I've just timed it. 6 seconds the gap.
6 seconds. They're about to hit the right-hand turn across the roundabout, and then it's along the esplanade with Corio Bay on the left-hand side. The finish line awaits.
It's not a done deal, but once she swings onto the promenade, she'll have a little incentive.
Amanda Spratt is at the front. She's doing the chasing. That's Spratt with the close down, followed by Lauren Kitchen, then Van Vleuten. Grace Brown is there.
I'll tell you now, Kate's selection of Chloe Hosking is looking rather good.
Well, where is she?
She's in there.
Looking to try and locate Chloe Hosking. You can see the LA Cipollini colours, the very bright colours, off to the right-hand side of the peloton. Anoushka is still in there as well. Anoushka Koster, the former Dutch champion, with her teammate still off the front. It is Spratt who's doing the chasing.
Oh, and at 1.5 kilometres to go, she's going to see the 1 kilometre kite imminently, but the charge is on, and Spratt is bringing Mitchelton Scott back into the thick of it.
Now the catch is on. Stultens has been caught. Shannon Molseed is still there. And number 31, Chloe Hosking. And she's got Costa just behind her. Rachel Nayland moving around the outside. And Georgia Bronzini in the black colours, number 42, is also in contention.
She's locked onto the wheel of Chloe Hoskins, the two-time world champion, picking up Chloe Hosking. Hoskins could go down to the same again here.
This is Amanda Spratt now coming forward. The look across the shoulder. Number four is Gracie Alvin. That's who Spratt is trying to lead out. It's now Chloe Hosking in a third position. Lauren Kitchen is on her wheel. Anoushka Koster is in the mix. Hosking number 31. She survived the climbs. Katrin Garford is also there. The Australian champion, Shannon Molseed, she's moving around the outside. She's got Jackson on her wheel. Audrey Cordon is also there. This is Spratt on the front. Alvin is waiting. So too is Chloe Hosking. Molseed trying to open up the sprint. Cordon is going. Cordon is trying to run for the line. It is Hosking that's desperately trying to get a nose in front. It's Chloe Hosking sprinting for victory. Bronzini is challenging, but it is Chloe Hosking who celebrates.
Hosking gets the line. Gracie Elvin will have crossed there in second place. And that was an unfortunate crash right at the moment of impact for Chloe Hosking. She got that one dead right. Well done, Kate Bates. She named him well out.
Chloe Hosking from Gracie Elvin, Georgia Bronzini rounding out the podium in third. There she is, all smiles. Never underestimate Chloe Hosking when her finish line is within sight. She's been in the top five before. Now she's on the top step of the podium.
Yes, she was fourth last year in this event. She's gone right to the top. Chain problem?
And just across the finish line, the chain has slipped off and is locked. But it doesn't matter now. She is the winner.
Well, that was a very, very good last 10 kilometres of racing. Sabrina Stulchens did so well. She did her best, and she almost read it absolutely right. The other two stars, Katrin Garford and the Van Vliet, tried their best, but in the end, they didn't have what it took. Hoskins took a gamble, waited, and won.
Former winner Rachel Nayland congratulating this year's winner, Chloe Hosking. There's Lauren Kitchen. Our race winner is down with Robbie McEwen.
Well, guys, Chloe is just going to have a bit of a run around to the teammates. We're going to follow her just to get some of that action. I think my camera's straying a bit further away, but Chloe, pretty excited, getting through with the win. Did you feel at some time it was not going to happen anymore when those three were in front?
To be honest, I didn't know they were there. That's what happens when you're struggling on the back of a climb. I thought we caught the Tibco girl, and I thought that was it. And then I heard some people on the hill saying that 25 seconds or something in front, and I'd actually watched the 2010 Worlds. I knew that it could come back over the climb, and you know, I was pretty adamant in the team meeting last night, if I get over the climb, I'm gonna win. My team director didn't think I'd get over the climb, so I asked first thing, where's my apology? I've been targeting this race since November, so it's the first race I've targeted and won, which I'm super stoked about, and it means a lot for my coach and I, so yeah, really happy.
It was a fantastic win. Tell us something about the sprint, coming in that last couple of 100 metres, knowing you're in it to win it and getting everything just right. What was going through your head coming into that?
Yeah, I was really nervous I'd get jumped from behind because it's such a fast finish, so I think I went with 300 to go, but I knew that it was fast. And so often if I jump first, they can't come over me. So I just put my head down and I sort of tried to channel Caleb Ewan, got so low. And then I think I won by a fair bit, so.
You did. How much of a huge confidence booster is this going into the rest of the season, finishing off the Aussie season like this?
Yeah, I mean, it is huge and it's really just a reward. You know, I worked really hard over the off season to get on top of things that I know were weaknesses. So, you know I'm not there yet, but it's just a nice stepping stone to show that I'm going in the right direction.
Well, Matt and Phil, you heard it. Chloe says she's not there yet, but pretty impressive. Back over to you.
Well, the rest of the professional peloton should be really nervous if that's Chloe Hosking not there yet. Her ability to survive the climb and defy the lack of belief from the team sports director.
I think she's got a great deal of confidence in her own ability, and she always did what she knew she could do best. That was mark the race. She knew she had no chance on the climb. She limited her efforts, and once over that climb, she got herself back into the race. She knew if she came down to the finish in a group, she would win the sprint.
And she never panicked.
That's the big thing.
There was nothing she could do about those climbers. She stuck with the peloton, just backed herself and waited patiently. A brilliant ride. Let's not forget the performance by Sabrina Stultens, caught with just on 1 kilometre to go. That was an outstanding performance by the young Dutchwoman.
Yes, it was. I think we'll be talking about her in the future. She will take a lot of confidence from that. I mean, just a moment's hesitation by the chase and she would have stayed away to the victory that.
And the tactical nature of the sport, you can't help but wonder what would have happened if those three leaders, along with Stultens, Garfoot and Van Vleuten, if they had have stuck together, they might have survived, but they didn't. And it came down to this sprint finish, and Chloe Hoskins, she'd marked Gracie Elvin. She knew the lead out from Mitchelton Scott. Here's a look at the fall as well on the right-hand side. And that looks like it was Jackson that went down heavily from the Tibco team. And she opened up, and she was never really challenged, was she?
No, this is she won similarly in Adelaide as well. This was our last win and our first win of the year. This is her second. And she's very fast. If you give her the chance to wind that sprint up, there's not many people can beat her anywhere in the world.
Gracie Elvin in second position. And adding to the prestige of the victory, in third place, Georgia Bronzini. Let's head back down to Robbie McEwen.
I'm here with Gracie Elvin, second place. Gracie, your team threw absolutely everything at the race. And at the end, it looked like you could have had it won with Annemiek van Vleuten. Everything came back, and then it was over to you.
Yeah, no, it's one of those races where anything can happen, and in previous years it's been a small group or solo, so it was looking like that today. But I think with that, the Shalambra climb and the heat, it really made a big difference to the bunch today. And yeah, I was just trying to save it all for that sprint just in case, and Spratty and Annemiek looked after me in the last couple of K, and then Spratty did a super good long lead out for me, and Chloe just got the jump on me, and she's arguably the world's best sprinter, so I'm really happy to get second.
It was a fantastic sprint that you did, and in front of Georgia Bronzini, former world champion. So all day long, the team was saying to you, take it easy, just put everything on the sprint, don't try and make any attacks or go in breaks.
We were trying to play it by ear. Like, if I saw a good opportunity, I would have tried to attack, but I guess it was all down to that big climb, so I just needed to save it for that. And the wind wasn't in our favour today. There was quite a lot of headwind coming back into town, so it was easy to waste energy. So, yeah, I'm just happy to make it to the finish today because my form's still coming up for the classics that I'm really excited about.
And we saw it was quite a hectic finish as well. Were you aware of the big crash that happened in the sprint itself?
I heard it. It's probably the most awful sound you can hear as a bike rider, but that was just as we were jumping for the sprint, so I'm happy I didn't see it.
Well, excellent second place. Congratulations, and enjoy the podium celebrations.
Thanks, Robbie.
Back to you guys.
Certainly on target. Certainly on target for a good season once again, Gracie Elvin. Second position, never really challenged Chloe Hosking, who's much more a pure sprinter than Gracie. But Gracie can take, like Chloe, a lot of confidence out of this result for the season that lies ahead.
I think this will be a terrific boost for her now. She rides for the Italian Ale Cipollini team. And Cipollini, of course, was one of the greatest sprinters ever and holds the record for sprint wins in the Giro d'Italia. I think it's 40, might be more than that. There's the results for you confirmed. Chloe Hoskins wins. Not a fast time, really. 3 hours, 15 minutes today. Gracie Elvin in second place, all given the same time as they would be in the sprint. Georgina Bronzini continues her love affair with Geelong. She's been the world champion here. She finishes third here now.
Cordona was in fourth position. The Polish national champion, Polwozka, rounds out the top five. It was then Lauren Kitchen in sixth place. Let's head back down once again to Robbie McEwen.
I have the third place getter, Georgia Bronzini, former world champion. Georgia, did you expect at the start of the day that you'd be sprinting for the win on this tough circuit?
No, I didn't think about this. I expect more hard course, maybe from halfway to the end by the men's team, Milchenton and Australia. But I think they was pretty lucky each other. And they attacked that just in the second last climb. It was already enough to split the bunch and make it like a bomb exploding. I was a bit behind and I hang up and I had a mate, Rossella Ratto, that take me safe in the last piece of the race. So I'm just sad in this Australian period I just got a podium and a bit disappointed, but also happy because I always behind Aussie and it's an Aussie season, so I must be happy.
But it also says a lot about the level of women cycling across the board, that there are so many riders capable of winning the big races. It must be very proud for you to have been associated with that and been one of the ones at the forefront of pushing women cycling to this new level.
But obviously, for me, it's even harder, but I'm really, really happy that women cycling is really developing in a good and fast mood. So I'm going to cheer for all the young coming stronger.
Just take us through the final couple of 100 metres in the sprint. Your position, were you happy with where you started from? Tell us your perspective.
Well, I fight a bit to have Chloe's wheel because I realised that was faster in the little bunch, but was a bit too hectic, and in fact there was a crash, which I was able to don't be involved, and so I was a bit too much behind. But I think anyway, I think Chloe today had the best leg, so I think she deserves a win.
It's a very fine third place, even if it's not a win, so congratulations.
Thank you so much.
Georgia Bronzini, the dual world champion, she oozes class. A little disappointed with third, but acknowledging it was the woman with the best legs that won, and full credit given to Chloe Hosking.
She was faster than anybody. She was gaining distance all the way to the line. If we'd have gone another 10 metres, she'd have won by a further five. There's the boys who brought us the pictures, by the way, Matt, and what a great job those guys do. The camera underneath the helicopter there. Brilliant images today. Perfect.
Stunning backdrop. Geelong, the surf coast. It's been showing off the Great Ocean Road, the fourth edition of the Deakin University Cadel Evans Great Ocean Road Race. The yachts all ported here in Corio Bay. The Ferris wheel, which gets regular use, particularly throughout the summer months. Cardinia Park, you can see the towers, the light towers off in the distance, the home of the Geelong Football Club in the Australian Football League. Just back to Georgia Bronzini, 8 years ago that she won the world title here in Geelong.
Time
and
flies.
She's still right at the top of the peloton.
She is, but she's heading up to 40 years of age now, so one or two more years she'll probably have to come off at this level of competition. But she's such an ambassador for the sport. And
Meyer got caught in the dying meters, and it was Nikki's